I'd like to call the meeting to order.
We started here.
Madam City Clerk.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Councilwoman Brooks.
I'm here.
Councilman Dida.
Here.
Councilman Misitich.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Duhovic.
Here.
Mayor Campbell.
Here.
Thank you.
Voice, Emily.
I'm sorry, I'm getting over a cold. A really, really bad cold.
Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about it.
Okay.
You can always use your alternate if you need.
And let's announce the closed session items. City Manager.
Yes, Mayor and Council, we have on the closed session agenda a conference with labor negotiators. The agency representatives are Colin Tanner and myself. We also have on a conference with real property negotiator. We have potential litigation with the city. And then public employee performance evaluations, the city manager and the city attorney.
Great. So any comments from the public regarding items on closed session? I see no one here. So let's adjourn to closed session. We got a lot Great. On our plates tonight.
That's what I was thinking about. Okay, what's going on here?
Six.
We've got a static session.
Okay, so we could start.
Well, I've got one issue on that. All right, let me go ahead and call it to order. Madam City Clerk. Mr. City Manager, I'd like to call the meeting to order for April 18th. I'd like to apologize to the public. We have got an awful lot on our agenda tonight. We had an awful lot on our closed session agenda, and that's why we were running a little bit late. I will try to move things along as quickly as I can. I don't want you folks to have to sit out there in those hard plastic seats any longer than you absolutely have to. So, Madam City Clerk, we've got a study session that's on our agenda right now. Do you need to call the roll again?
Okay. Oh, we're going to
And
do
the
this.
Pledge.
Do we do it? Councilwoman Brooks?
Here.
Councilman Dida?
Here.
Councilman Misitich?
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Duhovic?
Here.
Mayor Campbell?
Here.
We have a quorum, Mr. Mayor.
Next item is the Pledge of Allegiance. I'd like to ask.
Study session, so it's.
Oh, I'm sorry. Let's do the study session first, and then we will do the Pledge of Allegiance afterwards. So, discussion topics on study session. I've only got one, and that's the June 6th council meeting.
I've got one for the May 2nd. I would like to see if we can move the two Rec and Parks issues to either the following meeting or the one after. I brought those issues to the council, and I'm going to have some problems with being at that whole meeting, so I'm not sure when it would take place.
Anybody have any problems with trying to work around that? If not, then I would ask Susan to go ahead and work with
staff. Can
with
change
staff
the, sure. I already talked to the city manager about
we'll,
this.
We'll certainly do that.
Thank you.
Fine. Any other dates? The June 6th meeting, we had mentioned at the April 10th budget meeting that we would make an attempt at modifying that date to either Monday, June 5th, or possibly Wednesday, June 7th, in order to accommodate one of our members not being able to be at the meeting. Anthony, are you good on the 5th or the 7th? That's Monday or Wednesday night instead of Tuesday the 6th?
You know what, Mr. Mayor, what I will do is why don't we just keep it on June 6th, which is the
right.
Tuesday, and I'll just call in.
Okay, good.
Okay, good. That solves that then.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, anybody else?
Move approval, and if there's nothing else, have the tentative agendas as amended.
Got a second?
Excuse me. Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilman Mizutich?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Duhovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes. Thank you.
Next item?
Mayor, if you can call public comments for any comments on the study session only. We didn't open it to the, if there was any. No.
Public comments in the study session?
No, you don't have to. Okay. Then moving on, we can reconvene to the regular city council meeting.
Do you need to do the roll call again, or are we
yes,
already
please.
Good?
Councilwoman Brooks?
Here.
Councilman Dida?
Here.
Councilman Mizutich?
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Duhovic?
Here.
Mayor Campbell?
Here.
We have a quorum, Mr. Mayor.
I'd like to ask Captain Barringer to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. So, next item, City Attorney.
Oh, I'm sorry, Jerry. Yes, on the closed session report, the items we had on the closed session agenda was a conference regarding the labor negotiations. Direction was given for further negotiations. On anticipated litigation, we gave a report in one matter. There was no reportable action taken. With regards to the real property negotiations that is listed, which is the lease of property. We gave a status report. There was direction for further negotiations concerning the litigation matter, Riverwatch versus City of Rancho Palos Verdes. We gave a status report on that litigation. There was no reportable action taken. On employee performance evaluation regarding the city manager, the matter was discussed and there was no reportable action taken, and the item concerning the evaluation of the city attorney was not discussed.
Thank you, sir. The next item is mayor's announcements. I don't have any. I'll segue immediately into the recycled emergency personal preparedness kit drawing. So we have two recyclers of the month. That is in an award we give in appreciation of using your blue trash recycling receptacles. And the winners this month are Andrew Bupre and Lila Revia. So congratulations. You will each get a check for $250. And remember, recycling, you may win $250. That is the city's way of saying thank you for recycling. In addition to winning the recycling drawing, these two have also won a personal emergency preparedness kit from the City of Rancho Palos Verdes Emergency Preparedness Division, which is a $60 value. So congratulations to those two folks. Next item.
Our next item, Mr. Mayor, is approval of agenda.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to move approval of the agenda, but I'd like to reverse items 8 and 9, which is because item 9 is basically ministerial, and so then we can move ahead with the city attorney's presentation.
Do we have a second on that? That sounds good to me.
Second.
Okay.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilman Mizutich?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Duhovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes. Our next item is public comments for items not on the agenda, and we have two requests to speak. Our first speaker, Nick Ryan Shirley.
Nick.
Good evening.
Good evening, Nick.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mayor. Good evening, City Council. My name is Nick Ryan, and I'm a seventh grader at Connections Academy. I'm here again tonight representing my National Junior Honor Society. I would like to encourage all the residents in Rancho Palos Verdes to come out and volunteer for the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy. When residents come out and volunteer to restore habitat, it makes the community a much nicer place to live. Also, when residents volunteer for the Land Conservancy, they learn to understand how important the native plants are to our environment. When you have native plants, native animals have a home, like the cactus wren and the Palos Verdes blue butterfly. The whole ecosystem becomes balanced. Without the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy, that has preserved over 1,600 acres of open space that many of us like to hike through, the community we live in would not be the same. Without the Palos Verdes Land Conservancy, every inch of open space would likely be developed and all the native plants and animals would disappear forever. I, too, want to encourage all of our residents to volunteer for the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy. They have a simple online log system where volunteers can see what volunteer opportunities are available, and log in whatever hours they can volunteer. It is a lot of fun for me to walk through sites and see the plants that I have helped plant growing. It is also fun to see trails I have helped to block off or see areas where I have removed invasive plants. It is important that remember that every hour spent volunteering is an hour that you are making our city a better place to live. So please, if you have a few hours to spare, come and volunteer for the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you, Nick. That was very well said. Appreciate it.
Our next speaker up is Max Ryan Shirley.
Good evening.
Hi, Matt.
Good evening,
Mayor, and good evening, City Council. My name is Max Ryan, and I'm a seventh grader at Connections Academy. I'm here again tonight representing my National Junior Honor Society. I live in Rancho Palos Verdes, and I really like where I live. Part of why I like living here is because of all the great open space, which is found nowhere else. Thanks to the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy. For the last couple of years, I have been volunteering for the Land Conservancy at different sites, such as the Native Plant Nursery, Alta Vicente, Portuguese Bend, and the White Point Nature Preserve. I think that it is really important for all people to volunteer time for their community. I want to encourage residents to go out and also volunteer for the Land Conservancy. It helps plants, animals, the environment, and makes our community a lot more beautiful. There are a lot of different volunteer opportunities available, from planting native plants, removing invasive plants, fixing trails, making new trails, blocking off illegal trails, potting, seeding, and transplanting plants at the Native Plant Nursery. There is also citizen science programs like the cactus wren monitoring program that I volunteer for. Every little bit a person does is so good for the community. Again, I think if anyone in the city has some time that's wide open, they should come out and volunteer for this great organization. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Max. Good going.
Great job speaking. Thank you very much.
We have no more speakers. Our next item is City Manager's Report.
Yes, Mayor and Council, a few items that I'd like to speak to tonight that I think are important. First of all is, April is California Earthquake Preparedness Month, and so we encourage all of our citizens to reevaluate all of their disaster preparedness plans and to restock emergency kits. It's really vital that every resident has an all-hazards disaster preparedness plan and emergency kit that allows for up to 14 days of reasonable self-sufficiency in terms of food, water, shelter, and prescription medication. So we have more information available on our website, and anyone's welcome to contact Tracy Bonanno, who's our emergency preparedness coordinator, who heads up our program, for more information and to answer questions. Second thing is the PV Drive East Traffic Safety Guardrails project started yesterday, and it's just going to be a hassle regarding traffic over there. It's going to take almost a month to complete all the installation. The work will be going on Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m., and it will continue to progress. It will start begin near PV Drive South, will progress to the north, and traffic will be cut down to one lane during most times during that time frame. And so please plan your traffic accordingly. Please plan your trips accordingly, and we'll obviously have flag persons out there directing traffic, and it's just they'll be doing that as quick as they can to be able to complete that work. And last thing is, part of the Healthy RPV initiative is our first community event, which is Healthy People, Healthy Pets, and it's Saturday, May 6th from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the City Hall site in the grassy area. We actually have grass this year because of the rains this winter. It's great. So the event is designed to bring healthy area resources, information, and services to RPV residents and their pets. It's free. It's open to the public for a fun day for families and pets. There will be booths and demonstrations for people, human hamster ball races, high voltage fitness for kids demos, pickleball demos, all sorts of different demonstrations and information for pets about pet sitting, dog obedience class demos, so on and so forth. And so we'd invite all of our residents to show up and come out and learn as much as they can about new healthy lifestyles for themselves and their pets.
And what was that date again?
May 6th, Saturday, May 6th, from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m.
Got it. I know, right. Councilman Brooks had a comment about PV Drive East.
Yeah, thank you. Mr. City Manager, as you know, I sent an email to you and Doug Pritchard from Rolling Hills Estates about all of the infrastructure work going on the roads, particularly the arterials around Palos Verdes Drive, all the way around, PV Drive North, West, East, and South. And we know it was a nightmare last week on Palos Verdes Drive South, really bad, bad, bad nightmare. Half hour, people were waiting. My concern about PV Drive East, right now we are still in school, mm-hmm. and we have three schools in session. Right. We have Mural East, and Mural East is already a traffic nightmare. We have Milo across the street, and we have Mira Catalina. And then at the end, of course, going on to PV Drive North is Dapple Gray. My concern is that you try to direct these traffic people to work around the school hours, opening and closing. I mean, you're saying 8 o'clock, and you know that's when they're getting there, 8:15. So if you can work with them, I would appreciate it. I think the people would appreciate it because there's a ton of people coming from the other side of the hill over to Mira East. Thanks.
Mr. Doug? Mayor, I also have a question. So if I just heard clearly, we're going to start this work at the intersection of PV Drive East and South and moving north, all ending up where Dead Man's Curve is?
To
Conestoga.
Conestoga, yeah.
Dead Man's Curve, past Dead Man's Curve, okay.
And so I will say to Councilwoman Brooks, we'll certainly take a look at that. Once we start to look at school hours, it means that you're really having a contractor work almost a half day as opposed to a full day. And I promise that we'll certainly take a look and see what that does to the cost, as well as then it extends the schedule out for the work. And anyway, well, ideally we'd do it at night or something like
that. I don't
know if
weekends are at night or not.
That's also going to be more expensive. But it's something we'll examine to see if there's anything that can be done.
What's the cutoff date in your estimation as to when decisions like that would have to be made?
Well, it's already started, and so we'd have to look right now to see if there's anything that can be done. If the cost is exorbitant, and if there is something that can be done and it's just more costly, we'd have to bring it back to the council. If it's above my authority, we'd have to bring it back to the council 2 weeks from now, which means the project's going to be 3/4 done by then anyway.
Okay.
But I do promise we'll look and see if there's anything that can be done to alleviate some of those concerns, especially around school times. and see if we can do something.
All right, thank you. Next item.
Our next item is the consent calendar. Late correspondence was distributed prior to the meeting regarding item F. We have one speaker on item D.
Approval of the consent calendar with item F to be held immediately after this.
Second.
Item D. D as in?
D and F.
Speaker. We have the speaker on D.
We have a speaker on D. We received late correspondence on item F.
All right, and I'm going to pull item F too. Okay. So my request is that we hear item D immediately following the approval, and then we move item F to the end of the agenda.
I'll second that. Mr. Mayor, I have a quick comment on item G. If I may.
Sure.
If you haven't taken a look at our independent auditors' agreed-upon procedures, this is something two-time former Mayor Dida brought forward and worked diligently on for 2 years. I would take a look at it. I think RPV is one of the, if not the most transparent cities when it comes to employee compensation, benefits, et cetera, and that was a long time in coming. Take a look at item G. I think it's pretty impressive. We actually asked the state controller to mirror that and have yet to hear back on that. So anyway.
Thank you. It's really good.
Excellent. Councilman Misitich?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes. Our next item is
D.
Our next item is item D on the consent calendar, and we have one request to speak. Our speaker is Howard Duruther. Excuse me, I'm sorry.
No problem, Duruther.
Good evening,
Mr. Mayor and City Council. My name is Howard Duruther, and I'm here to ask the City Council to reconsider the recommendation, by the City Claims Administrator to reject my claim against the city for $6,835.61. I'm assuming that the City Council and the Mayor have been able to review my claim against the city. Is that correct? Okay, great, thank you. The basis for the City Claims Administrator's rejection of my claim was that the rocks that came down the road was from property that was not owned by the city. I was instructed by the office to seek recompense from those two public residences. Excuse me. I'm here because this evening because I believe that the city had responsibility for public safety and was previously aware of the unstable ground adjacent to a public street. This fact was proven by the existence of orange city cones located on the street to notify pedestrians of mud on the sidewalk. I have three issues to which I believe the city did not ensure public safety on the morning of my accident. The first is that no preventative measures were taken, either temporary in the form of orange netting or permanent, as you see in other places on Crenshaw Boulevard, and nothing was done to prevent any additional rocks from falling down the hill. The second, there were no signs or indicators to any of the people on the road. There was no cones, no lights, nothing that was actually on the road to allow me to know there would be needed more caution. In fact, after my accident, during a subsequent rainstorm, lights were put out, cones were put out, and then now there's a falling rock sign, I think, as a direct result of my accident. Finally, I believe that the city has known for some time that there has been an issue with falling rocks on the street. I interviewed the LADOT bus driver, and he had told me that he always sees rocks falling in the after a rainstorm. He kicks them to the side of the road, and somehow these rocks get picked up off the side of the road. I believe it's someone from the city who would actually clear the streets. So debris is actually in the road. My claim to the city is just simply to be made whole for the costs incurred to me and to my property as a result of this accident. I'm not asking for pain and suffering. I'm not asking for any damages or for lost work time, even though I had to take vacation to deal with this issue. Thankfully, only damage was done to my property. My 12-year-old son in the front car, in front seat, and myself were not harmed. So thankfully, that worked out. but I believe that this is a reasonable request being made for someone dealing with damage done to their property. And I ask that you confirm and honor my claim for the amount in my claim. That's it. I'm out of time.
All right, great. Thanks.
Thank you.
Mr. City Attorney, was it one of your staff that was familiar with this particular claim, or can you speak to it?
Carl Warren handles the claims adjustment process, so they look into matters, they determine what the facts are, and it's their recommendation that's in front of you.
I'm pretty familiar with this street here, and I would be in favor, particularly since Mr. DeRuiter, I didn't know you were going to be here tonight, but you did come here. I would be in favor of pushing this particular item back to the next council meeting to give us a little bit extra time to talk amongst ourselves before a final decision is made. That's just my particular point of view on this. I'll leave it to the council if there's a second, or if you want to make a decision now.
Second.
Can we get a roll call, please?
Excuse me, Mr. Mayor. If before you take a roll call, would there be any specific action that you'd like staff to do in the 2 weeks, or would you? Is the vote you're taking just to have this back on the agenda and have us do nothing additional? If you'd like us to do something additional,
the latter is what we're voting on. And then if council people would like to weigh in with staff and get a little bit more information, then they'll have that opportunity.
Okay.
I think one thing that would be normal if you're taking some more time is we would convey the remarks back to Carl Warren and see whether that affects their recommendation.
I think that's a great idea.
Okay, good.
Yeah. Okay, good. And Mr. DeRuiter, you understand this doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to go against what our insurance people have suggested. We're just going to take a little bit more time to look at it.
That. Yes.
Okay, good. Please call the roll, please.
Councilman, excuse me, Councilman Misitich?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes.
All right, thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Next item.
Our next item, Mr. Mayor, is a public hearing, consideration and possible action to modify the park's master plan to include, excuse me, outdoor interactive exhibits at Lower Point Vicente Park. Notice that the public hearing was duly published and noticed. Late correspondence was distributed prior to the meeting, and I currently have five requests for speakers.
All right, great, thank you. Could
the second one after the first two slides?
I know.
So, Parks and Rec, take it away.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Mayor and City Council. So, I wanted to go through just a quick background on where we're at today. So, running through this quickly, I'm going to be introducing Fran Simon, the president of the Docents. She's going to be doing the presentation on behalf of the Docents. So, just quick background, September 2nd, 2008. City Council adopted the Palos Verdes Coast Vision Plan, and then in November 20th, 2012, City Council adopted and replaced the Vision Plan, which was to replace the Annenberg Foundation Plan. Prior to conducting workshops, staff formed a focus group that included stakeholders and one council member to assist to go back to the public and get feedback on what the new vision plan that they'd be bringing to council would be. There was two workshops held, February 5th, 2015, and March 25th, 2015, and those were held at PVIC. At the July 7th, 2015 City Council meeting, staff presented the Lower Point Vicente vision plan portion of the portion for Lower Point Vicente for the vision plan. There's much discussion. City Council voted to amend the vision plan to exclude the docent exhibits And there was also mention of removing the Wall of Honor and locating that up to the Upper Point Vicente or the Civic Center site. So, Aura, can you? Thank you. August 4th, 2015, the docents established a outdoor exhibits viability plan. This was to gather feedback from the docents if they wanted to move forward with bringing this back as an item to council. On October 6th, 2015, City Council adopted the Parks Master Plan, which then converted the vision plan into the Parks Master Plan. So that's where that document currently stands. The docents held three presentations to their membership on April 6th, April 15th, and April 27th, 2016, where they received direction from their membership to move forward, and they had support from their membership to bring it to council. At the August 2nd, 2016 City Council meeting, the docents presented their plan and asked the council to reconsider their original proposal to have the exhibits in the plan. There were the City Council voiced several concerns, which included the exhibits did not fall in line with the city's less is more philosophy, the proximity of the exhibits to the nearby residents, the security of the exhibits at night, and also lack of support specifically from the nearby residents. So they directed the docents to work with staff to bring this item back to council, and that's where we're at today. So I will turn it over to Fran, unless anyone has questions for me.
Great. Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening. Good evening, Mayor and City Council. Again, my name is Fran Simon. I'm president of Los Serenos, the Point Vicente, and I'm here to present the presentation. Lower Point Vicente Interactive Outdoor Educational Exhibits Concept Plan. Los Serenos' mission, a volunteer organization which assists and supports the City of Rancho Palos Verdes objectives for the Point Vicente Interpretive Center, Abalone Cove Shoreline Park, Forestal Nature Preserve, and the trails at Trump National. The docents and volunteers provide interpretive and educational services to the community regarding the unique features and natural and cultural history of the Palos Verdes Peninsula and adjacent waters by means of docent-led tours, special events, workshops, and classes. Go back one. Schedule of events. I want you to read with me three or four special events that we had here. On September 27th, we had an outreach community workshop. On December 6th, we had an outreach community workshop. On January 25th, we had an outreach community workshop. On January 26th, we had a presentation to the Oceanfront Estates Homeowners Association Board. On February 9th, we had an Oceanfront Estates Homeowners Association poll. And today we're here to recommend a concept plan to the RPV City Council. Okay, this is the Lower Point Vicente Master Plan as it is approved right now by Rancho Palos Verdes. You see two parking lots, number two. You see Point Vicente Interpretive Center is number one. Number six is picnic area. You have a bathroom at number four, you have lookouts at number five, and grasslands at number six. And then you have dotted trails all along the perimeter and through the grasslands area. Okay, this was the initial concept plan that the docents brought with the exhibits and the signage. We had a Tongva exhibit, a geology exhibit, an archaeology dig, Annie's stand. We had signage, a whale watch sign, a Spanish rancho, and World War II sign. They were spread out all over the trail system throughout the entire Lower Point Vicente. The community workshops. The docents held three community workshops. Eight Oceanfront Estate residents attended. Most were from the homes along the fence. 6 additional Rancho Palos Verdes residents attended, for a total of 14 people attending other than the docents. The Oceanfront Estate homeowners had some concerns. First of all, they did support the educational aspects of the exhibits, but their major concerns were that the exhibits were too close to their homes. They feared Disney-like exhibits would attract crowds and traffic. They feared noise from tours, and they wanted an assurance that children's tours would be limited to weekdays between 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. They disapproved of the trailhead access off of PV Drive West, and they were concerned that the city has not maintained natural habitat due to lack of watering. They were also concerned about the peregrine falcon. In 1975, they were put on the endangered species list. In 1999, they were removed from the endangered species list. Los Serenos and the city of Rancho Palos Verdes will take care not to harm the falcons when installing the exhibits. Any construction would not impact nesting and breeding season, February through March and through May. Security of exhibits. All interactive exhibits in storage areas are locked when not in use. Presently, vehicle access is restricted by a gate that is locked at sundown by a private security company. Walk-in traffic would be no better or worse than in any other city park. The area is isolated and off the main road with no lighting. Graffiti would be at a minimum. Signs could be covered with protective films that would facilitate the removal of any graffiti. Exhibits would be located so as to facilitate line-of-sight inspection by patrolling sheriff. And I called the sheriff's department, and they patrol the area at least 3 times a day, including the nighttime. Lower Point Vicente concept plan. This is the recommended new location of the exhibits. As you can see, we have the Tongva exhibit, the geology exhibit, the archaeological dig, and Annie's stand. We got rid of all of the signage. We also have number 5 and number 3. There are 2 trailheads. It was recommended to eliminate those trails by the focus group. The exhibits are further from the homes than they were originally in our plan a year ago. As you can see, the outline of the proposed exhibit area, it is against PV West. It is where the gravel parkway parking lot is, and it's also near where the new parking lot is going to be, so that the children can ride up into the parking lot, disembark, and go right to the new exhibits. It's 0.6 acres of 12 acres of land at LPV. So we took your advice for less is more. I particularly like this one, this slide. It says distance from homes. The distance from the homes to our exhibits is anywhere from 500 feet to 661 feet, not the 150 feet that they were. The proposed interactive educational exhibits. An interactive exhibit encourages physical participation on the part of visitors. It involves and goes beyond seeing. An interactive exhibit can be touch, smelled, felt, heard, or manipulated in some way and provides some kind of information or invokes feelings that cannot be had by simply viewing a thing. An interactive exhibit has a hands-on component. The interactive exhibit engages you, makes you wonder, think, get excited, and makes you want to learn more because it engages you in the subject matter and thereby broadens the visitor's understanding and experience. The interactive Tongva exhibit will provide both children and adults with a better understanding of Tongva history in Rancho Palos Verdes. Visitors will have the opportunity to explore Tongva cultural heritage through activities combining traditional art forms such as painting and craft design and creation. The interactive geology and fossil exhibit. Visitors will have the chance to find various fossils, like let's say a viper fish or a plant, by looking on a diagram of what the fossils look like and then walking around or climbing around if you're a child and finding that particular fossil. The visitor will then be able to tell through the cutout in the rock formation what period of time that fossil was formed in, like the Miocene age. The interactive Annie stand exhibit. Annie Ishibashi ran the stand almost every day from the 1950s to 1992 when she passed away. James, her husband, and his daughter took over the stand until they closed it in 2002. In 2011, the city of Rancho Palos Verdes announced that the stand would be disassembled and stored for possible reconstruction at a future location. We want the location to be Lower Point Vicente. Annie's stand sold strawberries and some vegetables and flowers. The Japanese farmers used a method of farming called dry farming. That is what the children will learn about. They will have the opportunity to put some soil mixture into a cup and plant a garbanzo bean seed. They will be able to take this cup with the seed home with them. With a minimal amount of water, they will watch it grow. We will use garbanzo beans because that was a plant that grew quite well on the farms in Rancho Palos Verdes. Annie's stand represents Japanese dry farming and represents a part of history on the hill. It is an icon and belongs on Lower Point Vicente's property, just like Bubbles. The interactive archaeological dig. The program would introduce students to a fun program with high learning potential, archaeological field recovery, digging into the sand with a trowel, screening through the sand, an artifact identification, measurement, bag labeling, note-taking, and more. All of these activities have taken place on the peninsula, some right here in Rancho Palos Verdes, and some are still going on today. This is a way to teach children in one condensed area of Lower Point Vicente about four important components of our rich natural and cultural history, which is part of Los Serenos' mission. This is a way to get children and visitors involved in learning and experiencing, remembering and cherishing these special aspects of nature and of our culture. PVIC usage remains the same. So, to reduce the noise level, we would limit the time and days for school exhibit field trips to during the week between the hours of 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Tours are not scheduled every day of the week. In 2016, there were only 44 scheduled tours of PVIC. We anticipate this amount will continue in the future. 14 of these tours were from PVP USD. 3 were senior citizen groups. We will also allow small groups like the Scouts to the exhibit field trips on the weekends. The planned activities do not impact any of the neighboring homes. We took a special poll of Oceanfront Estate residents. The majority of the residents showed no interest in the outside exhibits. There are 79 homes in Oceanfront Estates. 11 are directly along the fence line of LPV. An additional 10 are in proximity of the fence. We held a separate email vote of those 21 residents. Between 6 and 8 responded to the HOA, and all were negative. The land deed restrictions. 1978 land transfer agreement restricted usage to public parks and public recreation. Field trips are consistent with passive uses as defined in 1975 general plan, as it includes nature studies, hiking, etc. The cost estimate based upon Storyline's proposal for the design and building of the exhibits is $340,000, which the docents will pay for. Today we come to seek City Council approval. We modify the Parks and Recreation Vision Plan for Lower Point Vicente by adding the interactive outdoor educational exhibits and concept plan. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are you answering questions or is staff answering questions?
I can answer questions or...
Open to both.
So questions from the council. Do I need to open the public meeting or...
Yes, you do, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. I'll open the public meeting. Questions from the council?
Yes. This is kind of unusual because I'm asking questions of an applicant as opposed to asking questions of the staff.
Ask questions of both. It depends on what the question is as opposed to who will answer.
Okay. First of all, it looks like you've really diminished the size of this and in deference to the council's current philosophy about less is more. But I did want to ask some questions. So you polled Oceanfront Estates people and all the only responses you got were all negative? Even after the
eight
lower?
Responded, and they were negative.
But those were the only responses you got?
Yes.
And the next question was, you say here that you have the weekenders, you know, and that was one of the big requests, was not to have these on weekends. When you mentioned the words small groups to be on weekends, how many would you anticipate?
In the group?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe 10 to 12.
And how many groups would, how many of these per year would you anticipate?
Last year we had 10.
But, okay, so we're going forward now with a new program. So the anticipation is that there are going to be more. And so that's my concern, at least. I'm trying to find out from you.
Sure. We would schedule it particularly for 10 groups to come, Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts or some other group.
Okay, and then I have one more question. You said you wanted to limit the number of tours, and that was one of the requests by the people in the community who are directly affected there. And last year you had 44 tours, 14 of those from Palos Verdes School District, 3 were seniors. How many do you anticipate next year?
The same
question.
It's the same amount, 44. We're going to limit it. We're not going to increase it.
Okay, so in other words, what you're saying is they're going to tour the facility first, and then they're going to go to these exhibits?
No, not necessarily. Some groups might only want to go to the new interactive exhibits.
Because they'd already seen the others, particularly
exactly.
The fourth graders in the Palos Verdes schools.
Exactly.
Okay. All right. I think I'm done with some of my questions for now. Thanks.
Jerry.
Are there any other restrictive covenants or prohibitions? I'm assuming that that's all been cleared. Is there anything that's even remotely controversial with this particular location?
Not for this planned usage. This is in line with the approved uses for the site.
other questions? Ken? Questions from staff?
They would have to. They would have to get a coastal permit to be able to do this.
Okay.
That's the real hurdle. Not us, but the Coastal Commission.
Yeah, and how big a hurdle do you think that might be?
Well, the city would be able to issue the coastal permit, but then it'd be appealable to the Coastal Commission because it's in the appealable district. It's so the city can issue the coastal permit through the LCP, but it's appealable to the Coastal Commission.
By somebody who might be opposed to the project.
Right. So it could conceivably, it could be done in a couple months.
Okay. I've got a question about some of the construction estimates on the various exhibits. How tight are those numbers, or are they just estimates right now?
They're estimates right now. We got them over a year ago, and they're estimates. They're not tight. We're not shovel ready. We're not prepared to, you know, to dig. We're still raising. We haven't even begun to raise our funds yet. So.
And that leads into another question that I had. In the docent's vision here, and I really appreciate the amount of time and effort that all of the docents have put into it, as well as your outreach to the community and keeping us informed as you go along. But a question I've got is there scalability to this? If fundraising, for example, might take a little bit longer than anticipated, can you go forward with a smaller scale with add-ons at a later date?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Which ones would you start with first?
We would all have to decide that together.
Okay. All right. Other questions?
No, I'm ready to close the public hearing and discuss this.
We have some speakers.
We've got some speakers. Sorry. Then we'll close it. Okay, thank you very much. Let's call the public speakers.
Susan?
I'd just like to thank Dan Troutner and the city staff and Herb Stark and everyone at Los Serenos who gave their input and helped with this presentation. I'd also like to thank the focus group, and I'd like to thank City Council. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Susan Dale?
How many speakers?
Six now.
Only six, yeah.
There were five.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Susan Deo. I've been a resident of Palos Verdes, Rancho Palos Verdes, since 1998 and became a docent with Los Serenos several months later. My experiences as a docent are among the most rewarding I've had since we moved here from the East Coast. I've watched countless children and adults be inspired by the awesome natural and cultural history of our beautiful peninsula during those 18 years, and I've seen the Point Vicente Interpretive Center go through many changes. I wholeheartedly support the interactive outdoor educational exhibits concept for PVIC. I applaud these experiential learning exhibits, which will enhance the educational opportunities for one and all by adding depth and breadth to the visitor experience at our center. I speak as both a docent and an educator. I have a master's degree in environmental education, and I taught ecology and the environment and marine biology at a local university for 16, 17 years. We, Los Serenos and the city, are known for our hands-on learning through field trips to our parks like Abalone Cove and Ladera Linda, and various theme stations on planned children's tours at PVIC, and of course the whale watching on our patio. Research studies and anecdotal evidence both support the importance of being outdoors in nature and participating in hands-on activities that enhance our understanding of the natural surroundings and of our cultural history. These experiences encourage curiosity and learning for children of all ages and support RPV's dedication to open space and to sharing the unique natural and cultural stories of Palos Verdes. They are the best way to learn. As one fourth grader said to a friend when they concluded one of our docent-led experiences, This is way better than school. Thank you.
Thank you.
Herb Stark.
Good evening, Herb.
Evening. My name is Herb Stark, and I'm here in support of the outside exhibits. I'll try to answer some of the questions that came up. We bring in about 4,500 students a year in planned field trips, and they're divided up into three parts. Some go to PVIC, some go to Abalone Cove, and the remainder go to Forestall. About one-third of those go to PVIC, and it's made up of three elements. There's about 900 students from the fourth grade program, and that's from the Peninsula School District. And then we have an outreach program, which is our Whale of a World program, and that is about 250. And then there's others that come in, and that's around 200. And that's about one-third of that 4,500. Now, what we've learned after about 10 years of running these programs is that the best way to impact children in learning is to get them involved in the process. After about 10 years, we've learned from the teachers that although they try to motivate the kids, they basically, by bringing in books and videos and reading material, that the best way that they found to impact them is bringing them into field trips like we have here, where they can actually experience the environment. Children learn in three ways. They learn by visual, they learn by hearing, and by doing. And what we want to do with the outside exhibits is add the doing element to the PVIC. When the children come and they interact, like we have on Abalone Cove or the Forestall, where they actually get to touch the animals and view the environment, they're motivated, and the teachers tell us that their whole experience is very positive. And so this is what we want to do at the PVIC, and that's why we want to add the outside exhibits. I have three short paragraphs that I'd like to read to you from the teachers. One said, "Hiking through the peninsula and learning about the plants and animals of the area provided a breadth of experience for my students. Overall, they learned geology, closely related to what we have studied in science, and they were able to recognize plants that were seen in our neighborhood." The second one said, "To be able to walk down the tide pools and observe the tide pool animals in their habitat was an amazing experience for my students." The last one, "The program has given my students an opportunity to see and touch things that they would only see in books, magazines, and the internet." So what we're really trying to do is accomplish with the outside exhibits is to provide an opportunity for the children to experience history rather than just view it. And this is nothing to do with adding more field trips. It's about improving the educational process. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have a question for Herb.
Sure.
Herb, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
So one of the big issues that came up last time when this was a different project was how to close these up when you're not using them so that you don't have people trampling all over them throughout the later evening hours, weekends, et cetera.
That's right. Well, Annie Stan is locked.
That Tongva exhibit is
pretty
large.
They're all locked up. For example, Annie Stan is locked.
How do you lock up a Tongva? Is that all inside a
No, no. That,
a pit?
That's a seating area like a campfire, and then there's a hut.
Like the size of this room. It's 40 feet.
Yeah, about 40 feet, about this area here. You get about 10 or 15 kids into it, and you run games and things like that, and there'll be one hut, which will be an artificially built hut, and it'll be locked, and that's where we'll store the teaching aids. Okay.
So nobody can go into that pit and get, like,
hurt or any, you know, liability-wise?
No, there's not going to be any pit. It's just sort of benches-like that they can sit around. And as far as
it's still conceptual.
The dig, yeah. As far as the dig is concerned, that's going to get locked. It's going to have a lid on it because one of the things we don't want to have it be used as a cat potty box, okay?
Yeah.
And so it'll have a lid and it'll be locked. And what we're going to do so it just looks like the environment, we'll have some artificial rocks or artificial plants on it so that when it's closed, no one will actually even know it's there in a way. So it's going to be very secure. And by being by the parking lot, the sheriff can come in and just look at that area and just see it directly. And the whole idea is line of sight.
Okay. Thanks for answering that question. That was an important question. Thank you.
Anything else?
Nope. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Ellen Johnson. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. Thank you. I'm Elena Johnson. I've been a Los Serenos docent for 25 years. This year we have toured, this year to date, we have toured 907 children from 16 schools for a total of 19 tours. Of those students, 764 were fourth graders from the Palos Verdes Peninsula Unified School District. One of the concerns that was mentioned during the community outreach was the safety of the children attending tours at PVIC. Part of what is required of every school that books a tour is that there be a 10-to-1 ratio of adults to children. The adults serve as chaperones, and they help assist us with keeping the children in an orderly, calm fashion. We also encourage schools to bring more than 10-to-1 when it comes to adults. Another concern is noise and traffic. We have never had a noise complaint at Point Vicente, not even during weddings. I would like to compare school tours to weddings. School tours are an hour to an hour and a half long, and they happen between 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. Monday through Friday. Wedding receptions start at 5 p.m. and end at 10 p.m., Fridays, Saturdays, or Sundays. A school tour comes in on a bus, and usually it's just one bus. A wedding party maybe have between 50 and 80 cars. The other docents and I always ask the children to be quiet while we are speaking and that they raise their hands if they have questions. Having staffed wedding rentals, I know that wedding guests are far noisier than a group of elementary school children. School groups have chaperones to assist with good behavior. Party guests do not. A third concern is the increase in tours. Having been involved in scheduling docent tours for several years now, I know that we are limited by the number of docents. There will be no great increase because we'll be unable to accommodate it. As we add docents over the years, we also lose docents for a variety of factors. In conclusion, I'd like you to remember that our PVP USD students are our largest group of tours. The outdoor exhibits would be a special and wonderful gift for future students from the school district. Thank you.
Thank you.
Diane Robinson.
Good evening, Mayor Campbell and City Council. My name is Diane Robinson, and I am a Los Serenos docent and an RPV resident for over 30 years. Though Los Serenos, as you had just heard from our president, has a mission and vision statement, we also have a value statement. And that statement is a commitment to learning so that we may be able to teach and share our knowledge and offer continued education to the public on the importance of protecting, preserving, and enhancing the history of the peninsula that will be enjoyed and appreciated for generations to come. And that is why I have very strong feelings for the Lower Point Vicente exhibits that highlight our area's unique geology, the fossils, the early artifacts, and the cultures, including the Tongva Native Americans.
But last but not least, close to my heart, I have a strong stake and feelings for our land and adjacent waters because I am a descendant of the Sepulveda family who settled here in 1781 to build a better future here. So this is my heart, my habitat, and my home. In conclusion, I hope and we hope for Los Serenos to continue working with, respecting, and reinforcing our relationship with the city of Rancho Palos Verdes and our community. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Henry Jurgens.
Good evening.
Hey, Henry.
Good evening, Henry.
Good evening. You'll be happy to know that I'm the last speaker. I've been a resident of Rancho Palos Verdes for 34 years. I'm a docent and the treasurer of Los Serenos. I'm also the past president of the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy, and I was so delighted tonight to listen to the two young people express their opinions of what they've gained through that organization. I support reinstating the outdoor exhibit concept to the Parks and Recreation Vision Plan. I want to emphasize, and this is important, that this is only a concept. It is not a shovel-ready project. The Point Pisani Interpretive Center provides many opportunities to visualize the history of the Palos Verdes Peninsula. We believe that the outside exhibits will become a natural extension of the existing Interpretive Center. As you've seen, we have answered the adjacent residents' concerns, specifically by moving those exhibits to the far end of the property and containing them in a very small area. I want to emphasize that all funding of the outdoor exhibits will be from fundraising by Los Serenos. No funds will come from the city. And as council realizes, I do have the experience in the past of raising these funds. The fundraising will be accomplished through exhibit sponsorship and individual contributions. Exhibits would only be built when we have the funds. I would like now to have a show of hands of those in the audience that are in favor of the Los Serenos proposal. I think council can see that we have a majority. I would like to reinforce what we are asking. We are asking only an approval of a concept to be added to the vision plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Henry.
Thank you. Thank you.
Philip Browning. Oh.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening, Mayor and City Council. As you can see, I'm not a docent. I'm the only one that's not a docent. I do come and ask you to reconsider. I do think there are a number of things that have been talked about today, one of which is noise. So I live in Villa Capri, which is pretty close. It's not oceanfront, but it's kind of interesting that they all voted no. So I think that ought to be taken into consideration. I do think that noise is a big issue. I can hear the weddings going on, if that's a question. I haven't complained about it, but I can hear them because I can see the Point Vicente. The docents do a fantastic job. I go by there every day running. The trails are getting busy, but traffic is getting busier. If you go down there in the middle of the day, you'll see a whole bunch of cars down there. So I would wonder how they're going to keep the number of kids down or the number of people down from where it is today. I think it's a great opportunity. I do think that many of you moved here because of the green space, the lack of traffic, the things that we all take for granted. I used to drive an hour and a half every day to downtown Los Angeles. I don't do that anymore, but I can really appreciate much more what we have here in RPV. And so I would just ask you to somehow ensure that traffic doesn't increase, that we don't have more people down there than can be handled. And if you go down there on many occasions, you'll find very few, if any, parking spaces. So I would say that it would be helpful if all of the Ocean Point and Villa Capri people had actually come out tonight. I don't think they did, although I did hear a number of people as I came in say they were not in favor of this motion, but nobody's speaking on that. So I'll just say I appreciate everything the docents do, and those are the comments that I have. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
No further speakers, Mr. Mayor?
Then I will close the public session and open it up to questions from council to staff.
And deliberation.
And deliberations amongst ourselves. Mayor Pro Tem?
Question of staff or the designers. Is there any thought with respect to the speaker's point about noise? Kind of seems my recollection of the topography there, it's up. Is there any, you know, unintended zoning or coning of sound? Is anybody going to look at that prior to this happening? Has it been, is it a non-issue? I'm just curious.
Again, this was just a concept, as the speakers stated. This was a part of phase one and phase two. The phase two was the outdoor exhibits. But once we get into the design phase, we could probably start addressing some of those elements to at least divert or just, you know, distract the noise.
And the safety issue, I noticed that was butted right up against PV Drive West. They're right around the bend right there. That's mm-hmm. obviously a major, you got kids running around over there. And again, are we going to put fencing or that's just too early to talk about that?
Absolutely. Okay. We'd look at safety, security provisions as well.
There is existing hedge that's, you can see actually in the design, that's pretty accurate with what's there right now. So that could definitely still... That can stay.
Natural barrier.
And you think that's sufficient to keep?
Yeah, it's pretty thick.
Pretty dense right
yep.
there. Okay. Thank you.
Ken?
Yeah. With respect to the noise issue, having moved it away from the others, clear over to the other side, I don't see where the noise will be any more than it has been for the past year. Since that facility is going to be locked down pretty much when it's not in use, I get the impression that it's going to be used only when there are tours. And those tours are basically a kind of program effort that's been going on now with WOW and with the PV Unified District, and that's less than one tour a week. So that facility is going to be locked down pretty much of the time. So, you know, it's not going to be an attractant. Because it's not going to be open. It's going to be specifically for basically learning for the children. And by the way, today, hands-on and interactive stuff is the way people learn. Museums are going to that all the time because they find the static display is no longer attract. So being based on a tour program, I don't see that it's going to increase the activity or, in fact, it's going to decrease the noise. And this is to be considered a citywide facility. It's for all the residents, not only those that abut the park. So with only eight people out of the park even concerned and eight people, the rest of the community hasn't spoken on it, I don't see where all those concerns really will materialize.
Thanks. Brooks. Thank you, Councilman Dida. Yes, as a teacher, as a former teacher, multisensory approaches certainly are the key. You know, you see, you hear, you touch. You touching these things is very important. For those of you who know where I've evolved from, it is looking at less is more. It's not only in the concept of space, however, it is also in the concept of activity, noise, what is social media going to do, how much more traffic is this going to be. I know that we can say conceptually it's not going to do this. I do have concerns, but I have to say I am very motivated by the way this project has been changed. I walked in, you know, I initially thought I would not support something like this, but I think there have to be conditions. And the conditions, when you probably look at this property now where this is located, probably the gentleman from Villa Capri and the people of Villa Capri are probably closer than the people over on the other side. Or at least the way sound travels upward, it would travel in that direction. So I think we need to be mindful. I can support this in concept. I would like to see staff work with them. I have a few concerns about the size of the Tongva exhibit. I think it might be, just from what I'm seeing initially, it might be larger than, well, it's certainly larger than I expected it would be at this point. I thought that would be smaller. And definitely they can't be a safety hazard to people going in. It's very commendable. I want to just commend the docents. You are one of our most precious resources because you have brought so much to the city to put us on the map. It's not just Terranea, it's not just Trump, it's the people that make it work. And in addition to all the committees we have and all the other activities, the docents clearly are out there educating with a smile. That's not always so easy to do. And the 100% fundraising, that's huge that you'd be doing that. But by the same token, just because it's 100% fundraise doesn't mean that this council would approve everybody that comes before us with a privately funded activity that they're going to fund themselves. So I'm eager to hear from my colleagues, but I can conditionally approve something like this in concept, that they work with staff and work to address conditions such as traffic, noise, limiting the numbers of people that would visit as well. Okay, thank you.
Anthony? I concur with Councilman Dina and Councilwoman Brooks.
Mayor Pro Tem?
I'm good.
I want to thank the docents for just doing a terrific job. I also want to thank the gentleman that spoke out about your concerns with traffic and some noise. You did a good job of disagreeing without being disagreeable.
Right.
We all could, in this world we live in these days, do with more of that. But I can't add anything else that hasn't already been said by my colleagues. I'm in favor of going forward with this as it's presented. So if I could get a motion.
Yeah, I'll make a motion here that we approve this modification in the Parks Master Plan in concept with the interactive exhibits and to work with staff and come back on the conditions that we've identified.
Second.
Call the roll, please.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilman Misitich?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Great. Thank you very much, folks.
Great. Can we take a break while we clear the room?
Let's break.
Yeah. We'll call a 5-minute break while we clear the room. Thank you, everyone. I would like to call the meeting back to order. Madam City Clerk, what's the next item?
The next item is item number 2, consideration and possible action to approve a revision to the conditional large domestic animal permit number 2, case number zone 2016-00465 for the Ride to Fly Therapeutic Riding Program. Notice of the public hearing was duly published and late correspondence was distributed prior to the meeting, and I have 2 requests to speak, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, and staff, could we get a report?
Thank you, Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, council members, and members of the audience. The item before you is a request to approve an amendment to conditional large domestic animal permit, CLDAP number 2, for the Ride to Fly Therapeutic Program to extend the existing entitlements 7 additional years and to extend the operating hours on Tuesdays through Fridays to 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. or sunset, whichever is earlier.
The subject property, located at the southeast corner of Narcissa Drive and Cinnamon Lane, first obtained CLDAP number 2 on October 17, 2000, where City Council adopted resolution number 2000-70. This is to allow for the keeping of 4 horses and the operation of the therapeutic riding program for children with disabilities. The 1.16 acre lot has utilized the site, this purpose for several years, and throughout those years, the existing entitlement has been revised and extended. On March 14, 2017, this request went before the Planning Commission, and by unanimous vote, the Commission adopted PC Resolution Number 2017-10, also seen as Attachment B within the report, recommending that the City Council approve Right to Fly's request to amend Conditional Large Domestic Animal Permit Number 2, thereby extending the entitlement by 7 additional years to December 19, 2023, 2 years more than the applicant had initially requested, and extending the operating hours on Tuesdays through Fridays to 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. or sunset, whichever is earlier. Therefore, staff recommends that the City Council adopt the resolution of the City Council approving an amendment to the Conditional Large Domestic Animal Permit for the Right to Fly Therapeutic Program, thereby extending the entitlement by 7 additional years to December 19, 2023, and extending the operating hours on Tuesday through Friday to 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. or sunset, whichever is earlier. This concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you very much. And how many speakers do we have?
We have 2 requests to speak, Mr. Mayor. Would you like to open the public hearing?
Opening the public hearing. Do you want to hear the speakers first before questions to staff?
Yes.
Okay, let's do that.
Sana Radville.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and City Council. My name is Sana Radville. I'm a parent of a child who has benefited from the program, Right to Fly, and I'd like to speak to the city today in support of their program and the amazing work that they do. We live in the South Bay. My son, who is 13 now, had the unfortunate event of having a stroke at age of 5 that left him disabled physically, but not cognitively. He knew how to play sports and do everything, and due to his current condition, he's on a wheelchair and unable to talk, but he's smart, he goes to school and has friends and et cetera. We got introduced to Right to Fly program a few years ago, and at the time he wasn't able to sit by himself or even support himself to be on a horse, and they worked with us, with myself and my husband, that we can be learning how to be sidewalker and be able to walk next to him. And we are very fortunate to have there his instructor, Monique, who worked with him and was able to communicate with him. And now my son is able to go to ride horses and think of that as his sport, write about it in school projects, and post some pictures on Instagram with his friends, and be very proud of what he does. When he first started riding, my husband and I were like basically weightlifting to keep him upright, and now he can ride, and we are still walking with him just to be safe, but he, as soon as he gets on the horse, he has the biggest smile on his face, and even when he's really tired and exhausted, he always says yes to riding horses. Right to Fly and riding horses, it changed his life, and always made him feel like he has something that is his own. He's not there to watch other kids doing things or his sister doing the sports. It's actually his sports, and he's very proud of what he does and his progress. So I'm here to just explain to you how Right to Fly has changed his life and our life as we work hard to make it better, and we ask you to support them and extend the ability to have more volunteers and more hours so he can continue to benefit from this amazing program. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming.
Gail Grove.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and city members of the council. My name is Gail Grove, and I'm the executive director of Ride to Fly. I've been with the program since 1998, and it's who I am now. We've been very fortunate to be able to do what we do in your city for 22 years. And we're very grateful for that. And I'm just here to answer any of your questions, if you have any.
Any questions?
I don't have any questions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your work.
No further speakers, Mr. Mayor.
Close the public hearing. Questions from Council of Staff or a motion?
I'd like to make a motion to move the staff recommendation, Mr.
Second.
Mayor.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? If not, please call the roll.
Certainly, Mr. Mayor. Councilman Vizetich?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes, Mr. Mayor.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you very much
for
coming
tonight.
Thank
you for your service.
Yeah. Great program.
Item.
Our next item then, Mr. Mayor, is the consideration and possible action to deny an appeal and uphold the Planning Commission's approval of a fence/wall permit for a 6-foot-tall wall along the easterly property line of 30931 Cartier Drive, case number ZON20160475. Notice of the public hearing was duly published and late correspondence was distributed prior to the meeting. We do have the appellant and the applicant here to speak, Mr. Mayor.
So, staff report, please.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. The item before you this evening is a fence wall permit appeal filed by the appellant Chandru and Bina Sujan at 30937 Cartier Drive for the construction of a proposed 6-foot-high block wall on the property located at 30931 Cartier Drive for Shigo and Miko Katawaki. In terms of some brief background on the proposed project, in September of last year, the applicant began construction of the proposed wall by excavating for some wall footings. The applicant was informed that the proposed fence would require a fence wall permit from the city. In response, the applicant filed an application. Staff conducted a site assessment and found that the proposed fence would not impair a potential view. And on October 25th, the Community Development Director approved the applicant's request for the construction of the 6-foot block wall. The appellant at the time filed a timely appeal. The appeal was heard by the Planning Commission earlier this year, and they voted unanimously to deny the appeal thereby upholding the director's approval. And the appellants filed an additional appeal, and that appeal is being considered this evening by the City Council. The next slide identifies the location of the applicant's property, identified in blue, and the appellant's property identified in yellow, along with the proposed location of the wall. And that is the area in the red clouded area. The next slide identifies a few drawings of the proposed wall. As proposed, the wall would be 6 feet in height, would be masonry block, solid, and be designed in an L configuration with approximately 52 linear feet of the wall. The appeal centers on three general issues. The first being that the fence wall permit was issued based on incorrect, fraudulent, and inconsistent information. More specifically, that the applicant survey was prepared at an unreadable scale. That the applicant survey does not correctly identify existing conditions on the appellant's property, And lastly, that the applicant's survey inconsistently shows the distance between the property line and the proposed wall. In response to the appellant's concerns, the applicant prepared a revised survey which addressed the different concerns of the appellant. In terms of the second concern, the proposed the appellant contends that the proposed wall requires the issuance of a grading permit, as the proposed excavation for the wall that was conducted altered on-site drainage flow on the subject property, and that the applicant's backfill work requires a remedial grading permit. The city's municipal code exempts the excavating of a footings for a proposed wall, so no grading permit is required by the code. In terms of the appellant's last concern, that the excavation of the proposed wall has resulted in a damage to the appellant's property, it's a civil matter between the two property owners and not purview to the city. So this evening, we're asking that the City Council adopt the resolution denying the appeal and upholding the Planning Commission's approval of the proposed fence wall permit. In addition, staff received some late correspondence from the applicant. The applicant is requesting to change the material of the approved wall from block to vinyl. The changes would not alter the height of the height, the location, or the amount of wall being constructed. This concludes my presentation. As mentioned before, the applicant and the appellant are in the audience and able to answer any additional questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions from the council to staff, or should you prefer that we hear the...
Let's hear from the appellant.
From the appellant and the applicant.
Clarify what Mr. Silva said. Did you just say that you do not have a problem with the solid vinyl material wall?
Correct, Councilman.
Okay. I didn't hear that. Okay, thank you.
Open the public meeting, and Madam City Clerk.
Okay. Our appellants are here, and I have Chandran Sujan and B. Sujan, so they would have a total combined time to speak of 10 minutes. And also, please note that Mr. Sujan earlier this evening did hand out some additional information, which is also on your dais near your late correspondence.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening. Honorable mayors and council members, we have lived in RPV for 39 years.
Sir, could you pull the microphone up higher so we could hear you better? Great. And if you could start his time over again, please.
Is my time 5 minutes or 10 minutes?
10 minutes.
Would both of you be speaking, sir? I didn't know whether to divide it evenly.
No, I'll speak.
Oh, just okay, certainly.
Yeah. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
Good evening, honorable mayors and council members. We have lived in RPV for 39 years. We addressed you with respect. We have, as an introduction for a few seconds, we have presented three photographs in this slide. The first one, which is says number one, is Mr. Kadowaki, our neighbor, and I standing in front of a very old wall, which was built in the 60s. It's just to show that the terrain is very even. It's not dug up in different places. Then number two shows typical damage to our retaining wall. The retaining wall is connected with our house, so it is likely to damage our house. We have a geotech report on that. Number three shows that while our neighbors were digging at our wall, the concrete grout has sheared off, so the wall has to be replaced. We have three main issues. The first one is changes to the original evidence, which is display number four. Next slide, please. Number four. Applicants tampered, no, I'm sorry. Our appeals were filed in November last year and February this year. Applicant tampered with evidentiary survey twice in the month of March this year, well after the conditional permit was granted and both our appeals were filed. We request the council to please restore the original crucial basis to conduct a meaningful process. City gave a statement on page 4 of the council report that only non-relevant information about the applicant was removed and no other changes have been made. This is not true. There are several other changes. Our display 4 on the monitor shows that one such change, which affects both property lines, on the underneath the number 4, that has been added. So the original prints have been redone. So the basis is not there for us to argue about. Changing evidentiary document is incorrect. We request that the council not deliberate on incorrect documents. Our second issue relates to display number 5, which is on the other side, adjacent to it. The applicant have provided incorrect information to obtain a permit. The incorrect information is fivefold different from the correct information as calculated on the right top of the display in a box. We have provided our source of investigation by a computer-aided design company in the council staff report. The permit was granted from a no-scale drawing as shown on the left side of number 5. The actual sensitively measured survey with high-tech instruments as shown in the center of the display was ignored, resulting in severe damage to our retaining wall, which I showed in my first slide. And that wall has to be replaced at a great cost. This shows that incorrect information is the main reason that the applicants changed their evidentiary document with two new replacements. City has never disagreed with our ceaseless production of correct 1/8 and 1/4 scale drawings. The Kadowakis, our neighbors, or their specialists have never disagreed with our investigated data. This is a clear case to apply Section 1786.060B to revoke or suspend the permit, because it was on the incorrect information that the permit was granted. Our third issue is display number 6. City documents continuously state that non-compliance with the Title 16 and 17 provisions have consequences resulting in disapproval of the application or suspension and revocation. City and Planning Commission's written minutes show that findings for the permit were based solely, and I've emphasized the word solely, on view and foliage considerations. The 7 codes on the monitor are non-compliant and incorrectly justified in city staff's report. Examples of those justifications are that the mistakes are inadvertent, but they affect us. They affect our wall. Replacing the evidentiary survey with 2 more surveys have removed the inaccuracies, according to the city. Past work requires no grading permit. I have handed the council members a two-page document showing that grading permits should have been required to save our foundation wall. Read another contention by the city is redistribution of soil for foundation work requires no permit. Our geotech report, which is contained in the main document before you, there is a report from our geotech engineer that hazards require soils report, and they would like to see the soils report before proceeding ahead. City's another justification is excavations are not considered for penalty fees. With so much damage to our wall, which is of great consequence to us, I think that wall was, they say reason is because wall was not constructed, but the digging was done. Damage to civil wall is a civil matter, we agree. Finally, manipulations of original documents is an incorrect solution. Applicants supplied incorrect survey is cause for council action. Non-compliances of municipal codes, all these municipal codes, none of them have been applied. Non-compliances of municipal codes plus incorrect justifications are cause for action. We request the City Council to disapprove the application or suspend the permit or revoke the permit. I thank you, sir and ma'am, for this hearing.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Questions of the appellant from the council? No. Could we get the applicant, please?
Certainly, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Kadawaki.
Good evening.
Good evening. So, thank you for allowing me to present some background information about our wall permit and the improper behavior of the appellant, our neighbor, the Sujans. So, this appeal is truly unfortunate, and it is based on nothing more than nitpicking, in many cases, outright lies. So, the Sujans are harassing us in retaliation for not letting them steal our land. So here's what happened. In March 2016, the Sujans removed the original wall that existed between our properties, and they, on their own, built a new wall that encroached nearly 2 feet into our yard, apparently to enlarge their driveway, or so it seems. I'm not entirely sure. But that's what they did. They built a new wall 2 feet into our yard. So after a land survey that we got proved this encroachment, the Sujans begrudgingly removed their wall. So they were unhappy, and they threatened us in a letter dated April 14th, 2016, that they, and I quote, are capable of destroying peaceful enjoyment of our neighborhood, end quote. That's exactly what they're doing. And they have antagonized every effort to replace the wall at its original location. So let's review their complaints. So the Sujans accuse our survey of being incorrect and fraudulent. They complain the survey's scale is too coarse, yet nobody besides the Sujans had any difficulty reading it. They also complain the detail view wasn't scaled, but per the California Land Survey Act, a scale isn't required. Nevertheless, to accommodate the Sujans' request, city staff asked us to resubmit a survey with these features updated. We complied. But now, the Sujans accuse this very gesture that they requested as alteration of evidence. See, our survey was never fraudulent, and updates were simply clarifications requested by the Sujans. And by the way, Mr. Sujan was referencing the scales on these surveys, but a scale of, for example, 1 inch on the scale equals 15 feet in real life. But what happens if you take that same piece of paper and blow it up on the big screen? I mean, the scale is not the most accurate. It's not the most accurate thing that determines how large a feature is. You require a hard dimension in order to show the critical features, and that's what Mr. Sujan is missing. And by the way, even if there was a problem, which there wasn't, updates are now incorporated, and the issues are resolved anyway. Next, they claimed we need a grading permit because the trench for the footing wall was supposedly 5 feet deep. This is deceptive. Photos, as well as a civil engineering report we have, prove the actual depth was less than 3 feet. So Mr. Sujan says 5 feet because he starts his measurement at the top of his existing retaining wall. But that doesn't make any sense. What if I measured the same trench this way from the top of the Empire State Building? It would be over 1,000 feet deep. See, this illustrates how deceptive the Sujans can be. In any case, the city staff observed the site and determined a grading permit is not required. Next, the Sujans claim the aforementioned trench damaged the retaining wall. Now, keep in mind, this retaining wall was built around 1964, so any imperfections cannot reasonably overlook over half a century of outdoor weathering. So that said, they reference a NorCal report, but nowhere on this report, if you read it, does it state that any damage has occurred. They also mention a structural engineering report, but it still contains no evidence that we caused damage. Additionally, our professional geotechnical engineering report states no damage to the 30937 site. Okay, next. The appellant also claimed we wouldn't let a surveyor on our property, and he referenced four letters. But simply reading these letters will show that we actually encouraged him to send over a surveyor. Okay, finally, they said we altered water channels. And they cited six railroad ties in our yard. But these ties have existed in their current locations at least as far back as the year 2000, before we even moved in. And water flows the same way it always has, so why is it now suddenly a problem? It's not. So, in conclusion, it is painfully obvious that the Sujan's complaints and nitpicking are based not on anything real, but rather on problems they made up. Our permit to replace this wall at its original location is important to prevent future encroachment. So beyond that, the Sujan's behavior is setting a bad example for our community. If you look into the public records, you will find that the Sujan's have periodically stirred up trouble with some of our other neighbors as well. But don't take my word for it. You can see for yourself. So we request the City Council tonight, as respectable authority, to deny this appeal, to send a message that this kind of improper and spiteful behavior will not be tolerated. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank Questions you. Of the applicant from the council?
None.
No? Okay, thank you, sir. Okay. I'd like to close the public hearing and deliberation amongst the council and questions of staff. Who's first?
I don't have any questions of staff. I have been through many a public hearing before, and I've been planning commissioner. This has gone through twice. I cannot find one finding that is met for the appellant, not one. And I'm really sorry, Mr. Sujan, but I really would hope, if my colleagues agree with me, that you can work together with your neighbor to ameliorate things, because there's nothing worse in life than not being able to be friendly with your neighbors and waking up each morning dreading to look out that window. Really, think about it. Everybody has probably been in that situation and either moved or made up. And particularly number seven, I look at item number seven on page five, where the applicant, the appellant was claiming damages. And if you look at this, it says between the two property owners, it's not germane to making the findings for a fence wall permit. And as for penalty fees, the applicant's wall was never even constructed. And the only work that occurred was the excavation for the foundation, which is exempt from a grading permit. So therefore, the requested fence wall application is not considered after the fact, and so therefore penalties don't apply. So, you know, it's unfortunate. I think you've spent close to $5,000 on this, but I would make an early motion, and if there's further discussion, we can discuss it, to move staff recommendation.
Second.
Any discussion, questions of staff?
No.
No?
It's been said.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. Please call the roll.
Certainly, Mr. Mayor.
And this is to deny the appeal. A motion and a second was made to deny the appeal.
That is correct. To adopt a resolution of the City Council of the City of Rancho Palos Verdes denying an appeal and upholding the Planning Commission's approval of a fence/wall permit for a 6-foot-tall wall along the easterly side property line of 30931 Cartier Drive.
Perfect.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilman Mizutich?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes, Mr. Mayor.
All right, thank you.
Our next item, then, is item number 4, consideration and possible action to appoint chairs to the city's advisory boards. Earlier this evening, I did place 2 separate ballots, as we do have 2 separate items to vote on.
Mr. Clerk, thank you.
Yeah, I thought I'd make myself useful. Mr. Mayor, if it pleases the council, for our Infrastructure Management Advisory Committee, Mr. Spain has been appointed the chair, with Councilwoman Brooks voting for Mr. Spain, Councilman Dida, Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic, and Mayor Campbell, and with Councilman Mizutich voting for Mr. Vanderlip. For the Emergency Preparedness Committee, Diana Feinberg was unanimously selected by the council to serve as chair again.
Thank you very much. Congratulations to the new chairs of these committees. It's important to note that all members stay on these committees. This is simply selecting who's going to be the chair for the next 12 months. And Councilwoman Brooks, did you have?
I think Ken was going to make a.
You wanted to.
Yeah, I thought you were going to have a break now.
No, wait a minute. Before we make this motion, when we also have the other committee chairs to approve. And part of this same activity?
Mr. Mayor, you want to finish this item or you want to break?
No, this
no,
is the same item.
Let's finish this item.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. I'd like to ask our Director of Finance, the storm drain user fee, the residual amount will be completed shortly and there will be no more funds for that? The actual storm drain user fee?
That's correct. We are not collecting any additional fees, and so when the fund balance goes to zero, the committee will be disbanded. But we will need to have one more meeting with them.
Okay, so the plan is as soon as that's completed, it'll be a wrap-up and the committee will be disbanded?
Once all the funds are dispensed.
We don't plan on budgeting any money in 2017-18 because there won't be any money to budget.
Well, we no longer have a storm drain user fee.
Right.
We have some residual funds that need
I
to
see.
Be spent. Once
yeah.
once they're spent, that project is done.
Correct.
Okay, and that's anticipated to be here in a not-too-distant future, right?
Correct.
Okay, then I would move that at that time, since the funds will be expended, the work will be done, the committee will be disbanded.
I would second that. I don't know if we need to make that a separate motion or just
The issue is to appoint chairs to the advisory board,
right.
So I don't think you've agendized the disbanding of the committee.
Okay.
I
want to
amend your motion.
I'll move we continue the chairs then.
A move that we continue the chairs and appoint the people who were just voted for, right?
Yes.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. The roll, please.
And I have to put that on a future agenda.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilman Mizutich?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes, Mr. Mayor.
All right. Call
congratulations, everybody.
Call a quick 5-minute break before we'll tackle the next item.
Actually, Mr. Mayor, I believe it's item number 5.
You're right. I'm sorry. It is 5.
Consideration and possible action to approve a settlement agreement with Vista Verde Homeowners. I currently have 3 requests to speak.
3?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And this is not a public meeting?
That is correct.
Okay. So could we get city attorney report?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, members of council. This is a very momentous night in terms of the action that that's before you, which is to approve a settlement agreement that would resolve a dispute that's really been going on for 10 years, since 2007. In 2007, the master plan for Green Hills was revised to permit the construction of a mausoleum within 8 feet of the property line adjacent to Vista Verde. And it was some period of time before the implications of all that were realized by the Vista Verde owners, but starting from when the construction of the mausoleum began, the Vista Verde owners have been coming down here to the city council, have been taking various actions to show the issues and problems that they were having with this. There was actually an annual review that was begun of this project in 2014. This was supposed to be an annual process to take a couple months. It took 2 years to go through the annual review process. It ended up with an appeal in front of the city council. And in November of 2017, the council approved a revised CUP. You know, I'm talking about the 2017 appeal that 2016? Yeah. The council heard an appeal, and basically the recommendation at that time had numerous changes to the conditions of approval, but one of the conditions that was inserted in that CUP, which is intended to resolve this dispute, was a provision that there be a three-party mediation, and the City Council indicated at that point in time that you would put up potentially $200,000 to try and resolve this matter. Subsequent to that action, working with the Vista Verde owners, we went through some process in terms of trying to work out the mediation. And during that period of time, the Vista Verde owners actually filed three lawsuits against the city. Those lawsuits are still pending. The city has spent considerable time in that litigation, and this mediation process has been moving in parallel. Initially, we had a little bit of a dispute over who the party should be in the mediation. Eventually, the city's initial process or position was that it should be a three-party mediation to involve Green Hills. The City Council's original intent was to try and, through this mediation, get the whole issue totally and completely resolved. After some discussion, the Vista Verde owners were not comfortable participating in the mediation with Green Hills, and the City Council eventually elected to do this mediation through a two-party process. On February 1, we met with a mediator through the good offices of Justice Hastings. We actually ended up with a tentative settlement agreement involving the city and Vista Verde. That agreement basically involved a payment by the city of $500,000 in settlement of the owner claims. The owners were each required to execute a release saying that they released all claims. There also would be a settlement agreement. The Vista Verde homeowners group that we've been litigating with only includes 21 of the 25 owners. So the city council wished to have something in there for the four homeowners that were not participating in the litigation to try and deal with their claims also. Through that dialogue, three of those four owners have agreed to release their claims. They would be paid $5,000 each for the release of their claims. We actually have received from those three owners, we have their signed releases in our possession. The, as I say, the fourth owner has declined to participate, but that would mean that with the 21 owners in this group and those three, we would have 24 of the 25. Also, the council wanted something that would be recorded against the property so that future buyers would be aware of this dispute, of the resolution of the dispute, and obviously of the existence of the mausoleum in its location. Through a lot of dialogue, we came up with a method of doing that, which was to amend the association's CC&Rs. And that would include this notice and also provide that in the event there was a one of the homeowners did try and proceed against the city, we were indemnified by the HOA, and they could assess owners in order to reimburse the city any cost we had in trying to defend ourselves. So I understand that I was told by the owners tonight that they've had a meeting, and the association has approved those CC&Rs, and they actually have a signed document at this point. So, and the settlement agreement, it's also my understanding that at this point in time, there's one owner who hasn't signed yet, but they've one of the two joint owners has passed away, and we have to straighten out what the title situation is there. But I think that my real estate attorney will be able to figure that out quickly. We have a joint press statement that we've agreed to that outlines this settlement. And the settlement agreement permits the Vista Verde homeowners group to continue their actions against Green Hills. So Green Hills has not settled their disputes with the Vista Verde owners. I've indicated that we basically have these documents are more or less in hand. We expect in the next few days, with your action approving the settlement agreement, we would get the city's side signed, and we will be able to move forward with the settlement. One other provision of the settlement agreement provides that while the Vista Verde homeowners have given up their past claims concerning the construction of the mausoleum in this location, we do understand that the Green Hills mortuary is not going to go away. It's going to be there for a long time. And the Vista Verde condominium is not going to go away. And so there will be future things that occur out there. And the Vista Verde residents are not giving up any rights that anyone else would have to comment on, to come in and represent, to send letters and disagree with actions the council might take in the future with regards to future actions. So that's well understood. I do think, and just something from my experience in this, I've represented cities for 40 years, and something unique to this, I've never once heard a council member comment that it doesn't matter, that working this out doesn't matter because these are Lomita residents that do not vote in RPV. Certainly you've never said anything like that publicly, but I think it's important, and I've said this privately to the Vista Verde owners, that at all times in my dealing with this, the council has been sincerely in agony over this situation. It's very unfortunate as to how it developed, and the council was, your attorneys were telling you that due to statute of limitations, we had some pretty strong arguments in the litigation, and that was not an issue that the council took into account in terms of trying to figure out how to settle this matter. And we were authorized in the mediation to offer a very significant amount of money to, with a sense of being that in some ways these people can never be made whole because of the nature of having the rooftop burial situation so close to the condominiums. So we don't pretend to think that this takes care of all the problems, but this is a very significant sum of money. They're going to determine on their own how to distribute it amongst the owners. And I've said to them, and it's comes sincerely from understanding the council's agony and all of our discussions in the last year and a half of trying to approach settlement, that the city feels strongly about the unfortunate circumstance, and the council is happy to come up with a solution that where we can feel with regards to our neighbors here that they've been made whole, and we go off into the future with the idea they are neighbors of this project, and any issues and problems they have in the future, we're glad to hear about them, work on them, and try and solve them if we can.
Great, thank you. We've got three speakers.
Yes, sir. Our first speaker is Mr. Noel Weiss.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Noel.
Good evening, Noel. Good evening, Council. Appreciate the opportunity to close our settlement that we, our mediated settlement that we effectuated back on February 1st. For purposes of the record here, I have before me, which once the council hopefully will approve the recommendation of the city attorney and the city manager, I have all of the documentation signed. I will sign the request for dismissal and also the settlement agreement, deliver the same to the city attorney. We have two individuals, Rich Martin and Matt Martin, who will sign. I just don't have them with me right now. So I don't expect there to be any issue, particularly since Matt Martin is part of the leadership team and he was at the mediation and he was also at our follow-up face-to-face meeting with the city attorney last month. So, Rich Martin had a series of questions which I answered in, I think, excruciating detail, and I don't expect that there basically to be a problem. The HOA is also signed off and will provide an opinion letter from the lawyer of the HOA saying that they acted in a manner consistent with the bylaws. So the only other factor I think that we have is that we've met, I think, all of the conditions on our end would be one of the co-owners apparently passed away a year ago. Atelia, it's unit number 112. So basically we'll work through a mechanism by which whatever we need to do to satisfy the needs of the situation, we will do. It's a question of timing. Mr. Alshire's firm is, I think, well capable of accomplishing our collective result. But I think basically, and the other three owners have been taken care of in our agreement. I'm talking about the other three non-clients, non-litigation people, have basically been taken care of, as Mr. Alshire indicated. My understanding is that basically under the terms of our agreement, the council is prepared to basically waive that last unit owner so that this person doesn't have control over the entire transaction. So, and that will be basically, their loss. But I think once we get the Martins in, I think, and again, the request for dismissal, I'm going to deliver that all tonight, and hopefully we should be able to wrap this up once the council says yay to what we've accomplished. But again, I appreciate the efforts of Mr. Alshire, Doug Wilmore, not to jinx it, but I also appreciate the anticipated vote of approval from the council, and I appreciate your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Brian Carter.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'll make this quick. So I am the secretary of the Vista Verde HOA. I have a copy here. Noel has a copy as well, the signed amendments. I did want to make one point on the proposed third amendment. Item C, that it says that based on the foregoing, various lawsuits were instituted by the association and certain owners. The association did not actually institute any of the lawsuits. Just want to make that clear as part of the record tonight. But we have signed off on that, and I'll be working with Noel and anyone else from the city attorney's office to get the paperwork from our HOA attorney. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Noel Park.
Yay.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
Oh, I just want to say that this is, I think, the best result you could possibly hope for. And I just want to thank and compliment everybody involved. And most of what I had to say, Mr. Alshire has already said, and I thank him for his eloquent comments. I spoke here once before, and I maybe a little bit too dramatically said that I felt like the sword of Damocles was hanging over our city, and I just strongly urge you to approve this tonight, and let's get this behind us and, go forward into glory. I think that Mr. Alshire said it, but I have to agree that there's a question of equity here, aside from the legalities of it all and the proper notice and the statute of limitations, and that is that, as much as I hate to say it, that the errors and omissions of city staff cause these people to be injured. And I mean, I think that as a matter of equity, we owe it to them to try to do as much as we can to make it right. And I think Mr. Alshire was also correct in saying that they can never be made whole, but I think that it'll make our city look a lot more forthcoming and wise if we go ahead and approve this and get it over with. I don't know if I should say this, but through this whole process, I've watched the operations of Green Hills and their business philosophy, which includes pushing the envelope of their planning entitlements as hard as they can at every opportunity. And maybe I'm restating the obvious, but I would just urge everybody, you all, Mr. Wilmore, Mr. Moranian, and your staff to watch these guys like a hawk all the time, because if we don't, I think you said it, you know, we could get in the middle of another deal like this down the road if we aren't really careful. Thank you very much. Please sign off on this.
Thank you for everything.
No further speakers, Mr. Mayor?
Any questions of staff or entertain a motion?
Yeah. I'd like to make this motion. I was mayor when this whole thing got started in 2013, for us, for everybody here at least. I'd like to make this motion to approve the settlement agreement with Vista Verde Home Runners.
Second.
And then I'll just quickly speak to it.
Motion and a second. Any comments before we call the roll?
I do want to make a comment. I'm sure we probably each do. This is very emotional for a lot of us. For me, I feel like I have actually been involved with these people and felt, you talk about feeling someone's pain, gone to sleep at night with prayers always for the Vista Verde people in my heart. And, you know, we have been, as a city, fiduciarily responsible to our city, but we are being fiduciarily responsive and morally responsive to our Lomita friends. And that's what's so key. It doesn't matter where somebody lives. It matters what is done. And we are all here on this council to support the greater good and what is right and just. So I look forward to moving forward in a productive manner with our new Green Hills management and the residents committees, and that would include the Vista Verde residents. And let's look at this Easter and Passover season as one of rebirth for all of us. God bless.
Anthony?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. And Susan, well said. I just want to say I'm glad this day is here. And I can't emphasize enough, we may have not said it publicly, but each one of us has agonized over this. And I just want to say that, sorry it's taken this long, but it's here. And I'm glad it is for you folks.
Ken.
I just want to compliment all the people involved with this very contentious problem that's gone on for a long time. It's been serious, it's been emotional, but the people involved really worked hard and ended coming up with a solution that seems to work for everybody. So my compliments to all those who were involved in getting to the point we are today, and I certainly support the motion.
Jerry?
Mr. Mayor, I concur with all of my colleagues' comments. Noel, in some sick way, I'm going to miss you coming up there and talking to us. You know, you were a zealous and passionate advocate, although we didn't necessarily agree all the time, but it was interesting to say the least. But I do want to say, for the record, being involved in this at the onset from negotiations and trying to work through, there have been several starts and stops throughout this thing, and it is a shame it took so long. But I'm happy we are where we are today, and I wish all the residents the best, and hopefully we can move forward and get on with our lives. Thank you.
And I'd like to say thanks to everybody on both sides of this for how hard they worked. The residents come in here every meeting. I mean, Noel, you did a great job for your clients. I can echo what my colleague just said. Didn't always agree, but I thought you did a good job. And the fact is, you're effective in that we've got, really, in my career, this is, I think, one of the more interesting win-wins out of a situation where I didn't think that was possible. But I do regret the circumstances that led to this. I said from day one I was not going to care who lived where and what side of the border line. I mean, there were things that had to be fixed here. And I'm really proud to be sitting up here with the rest of my colleagues and be part of the group along with our team at the city and with you folks also, with all of us coming together and solving this. So for that, yes.
One last thing, I was remiss in not recognizing Dave. I recognize Noel, but Dave, you worked very hard and it was painful for you too. So we're looking forward to seeing you going forward too. So.
And one other thing, I did want to thank our anonymous donor who did help us get started with the new mediations.
Good point. Call the roll, please.
Certainly. Councilman Mizutich?
Yes.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Great.
Couple of us.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Our next item, then, is item number 6, consideration and possible action to receive and file a status report on the city's arterial fences and walls program, to identify draft design options for an arterial fence and wall master plan, and to initiate code amendment proceedings to amend the development code relating to the arterial fence and wall master plan. I currently have 2 requests to speak, Mr. Mayor.
Could we get a staff report?
Certainly, Mr. Mayor and members of the City Council. As you know, back in July of 2016, staff brought forward for the Council's consideration an assessment report on the city's condition of the arterial fences and walls throughout the city. Based on that item presented to you that evening, the Council directed staff to move forward with some short-term solutions pertaining to the deteriorating condition of arterial fences and walls, with an emphasis on the existing chain link fencing and pilasters along Hawthorne Boulevard, and also directed staff to come back at a future date with a long-term solution to the city's conditions conditions of the arterial fences and walls. With that, staff has, since that meeting in 2016, staff has moved forward and began some of the outreach to educate the public on who owns the arterial fences and walls. And so I've highlighted here on the slide some of the steps that were taken since July of 2016. Staff, these are the recommendations. Staff actually went to the Council of Homeowners Association back in November of 2016 and gave a report to the members there about the arterial fences and walls, and indicated that the city would be moving forward with removing some of the chain link fences and pilasters along the arterial roads, and emphasizing that those walls and those fences actually belong, they're on private property, and it's the responsibility of the property owner to maintain them. Subsequent to that, we also published an article in the city's newsletter, and more recently, back in March, the city public works director sent a letter out to 128 property owners who have property, or their property line, the rear property line abuts Hawthorne Boulevard, indicating that the city in the next few months was going to proceed with removing the arterial, the chain link fences, and gave them an opportunity to sign an access agreement to allow the city to do it at the city's expense. And at this point to date, we've received 52 out of the 120, that's approximately 40% of responses agreeing to allow the city to remove the chain link fences. In considering all that, questions have come up as to, well, what's the next step? You're going to remove the chain link fences, and what are you going to do in place of that? Is the city going to come in and put in new fences, or is that going to be the property owner's responsibility? And that raised the question is, what's the vision of the city, and how are we going to deal with this on a long-term basis? And then what does the code allow a property owner to do based on the requirements? And so right now the code allows a property owner to replace a fence or wall along an arterial street in a material, color, and height that's similar to the track fencing that's existing. The code also prohibits the installation of chain link fences. So clearly, we're removing chain link fencing. We don't want a property owner to come in and put something in that doesn't that the code doesn't allow. So what we're trying to do right this evening is identify some design features that we want to get some input from the council so that we can forward this to the Planning Commission, direct the Planning Commission to come up with some design plan, a master plan for the arterial fences and walls, and bring that back for the council's consideration, as well as amending the code so that it's clear that the replacement of any chain link fencing or walls that are removed by the city have to comply with a master plan that's adopted by the city council. So I've got the next few slides just to kind of illustrate some of the design features the council can consider and forward that input to the Planning Commission for their consideration. Just looking, some of the things to look at are height. Do you want the future of the arterial fences and walls to be 2 feet or 5 feet or somewhere in between or a little taller? Do you want them to have pilasters or no pilasters? Do the pilasters made out of a stone, PV stone, or brick, or they could also be stucco? Do you want the fences and walls that are replaced to be a wrought iron, a stuccoed wall that has a color to it, or no fence or wall at all where it's more open? And there's certain areas along Hawthorne Boulevard that don't have any fences, and that's illustrated here with this image. There's also the option of a vinyl fence. Vinyl fences come in different materials now, different colors, and they also can be constructed with different heights. So these are some options here. There's a wood fence that you can consider as well. And these are some colors that staff was looking at that are that could come in for stucco or whether it's a vinyl fence. So essentially, we've got a series of questions here for the council, design options that we're seeking some direction on that we'll forward to the Planning Commission. Thank you.
Any speakers?
We have two speakers, Mr. Mayor.
Let's call the speakers, please.
S. Govind.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Honorable Mayor and Council members, thanks for giving me an opportunity to raise my concerns regarding the present fence removal aspect of it at this stage. Okay, a few of the comments that I'm going to be making, I have shared it with my neighbors. Two of them are here, and they agree with the philosophy involved in here. The existing fences offer several important features that I'm sure you are aware of it. It provides a deterrence to any kind of a vandalism.
Sir, I don't mean to interrupt you. Could you speak a little bit closer to the mic, please?
All right, can you hear me better?
And we'll give you some extra time to
make up. Can you hear me better?
Yes.
All right, so the fence provides a deterrence to any kind of a potential vandalism occurring towards our rear of the property facing Hawthorne Boulevard. It's a safety net for us residents. It also helps collect debris that can fall, especially with the kind of rain that we have had. So the absence of the fence will basically make all that particular debris to come onto the sidewalks or onto the streets. And this is a cause of a bad word called physics. Removal of the existing fence without a proper plan for a replacement is at best considered short-sighted. Based on my dialogue with Mr. Maranian, who has been very nice, the court came into picture after the RPVC became an entity having removed itself from the county. The original properties were part of the LA County. This code has not been enforced for at least 20 years that Mr. Maranian has been here. So he doesn't know when exactly this code was enforced. So as a consequence, giving us residents short time frame to react without proper so-called deliberation to alternatives is something that we consider to be appalling. Okay, if the city does want to enforce the code, then it basically becomes a responsibility of the city to recognize that this code was implemented after they took over from being the county, and therefore it should be their responsibility to remove the fence at their cost, as they have indicated they will do so, and replace it too. We recognize the need to beautify the place. However, it is crucial that the city recognizes the negative aspects of removing a fence without any immediate replacement in place. By forcing the enforcement of an arcane code, the city needs to be made aware that it shall bear the liability of damage to the properties caused by a lack of a protective measure, and it becomes necessary for us to initiate some particular type of a methodology of periodic cleanup, which currently we don't have to do it. The city will have to take the responsibility for doing it. And I also consider the city to be liable in the process for any damage that may occur to pedestrians and the vehicles. I'm also informed that the present plan focuses on enforcing the code only along Hawthorne Boulevard, whereas there are plenty of arterial streets, as Mr. Mehranian pointed out. As a consequence, it is, if the plan is to enforce it only on along Hawthorne Boulevard, we view that this is a what we call as a non-uniform enforcement, and this may be challengeable, and we don't want to get into any kind of a mess on that. So what I'd like to do is reconsider for you, the City Council, to reconsider the approach that they are taking place by adopting a replacement plan, then get rid of the fence, do the replacement such that the time gap between the two is minimum. Right now, you don't know when the replacement plan is going to be approved. That's my request. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Noel Park.
Hi, Noel.
Hi.
Good evening again.
I found this agenda item interesting, and I had forgotten that you had appropriated the money to remove those fences along Hawthorne. And as the staff report correctly says, it's the entrance to our community, and it's disgraceful, the condition it's in. I mean, a lot of those fences don't provide any security to anybody. They're laying flat where they've been pushed over by the dirt and the ice plant coming down the slopes. You know, and I've looked down there, and I don't know, you know, who's objecting to this lack of security, but most of those houses from Silver Spur down to PV Drive North have fences at the top of the slope. And, you know, the pilasters are laying over, and there may be some of it that's in a condition that might provide some kind of security, although the idea of burglars climbing up those slopes seems a little far-fetched to me. So, you know, I would, my suggestion is just redouble the effort to get the sign-offs on the encroachment permits, and let's go in there and clean the mess up. And if there are certain people who want to be litigious and threaten this, that, and the other because of their security risk, and leave the piece behind their house, assuming it's standing up. I mean, if it's laying down, they're creating a nuisance on the public right-of-way. The fence has fallen over into the right-of-way. And as to the replacements, you know, I'm sort of agnostic on that. It's really not my issue. But I did take notice of the no-fence option, which to me, in that particular area, makes perfect sense. Just tear them out of there and smile. And if people want to put fences up, we can talk to them about what they want to make them look like. I don't know how much of the chain link you have in mind to remove. I mean, clearly the casus belli is from Silver Spur to PV North. There's similar fence along Hawthorne, I don't know, all the way from Crest all the way up to High Ridge or someplace. It's basically the same thing, but most of those are at least standing up. I mean, they're pretty ugly, but you know, at least they aren't in as bad a shape as the ones down below. You know, we had a dispute with some at White Point Park with the baseball diamonds where the old rusty, nasty fence had been there for 60, 70 years. And they came in and sprayed them with some kind of vinyl coating over the old rusty chain link fence. And it looked about 100% better, and it's still there. So, you know, that might be an option for this stretch up in here if people are going to object to having it taken out. I don't know if you even intend to do anything up in this area. But anyway, I'd say all credit to you guys for appropriating the money. Let's clean that mess up and get on with it. Thank you.
Thanks, Dale.
Mr. Mayor, I need to make a motion to extend the meeting to 11.
Second.
Thank you.
So moved.
All right. No further speakers, Mr. Mayor.
No other speakers. Okay, so, Ken?
Yeah, I've got some questions. Is Silver Spur considered an arterial?
Yes, it is.
It is?
Yes.
Okay. And looking at this, is there going to be some provision for design continuity along a street where you don't have individual houses between one cross street and another having different kind of fencing?
That would be the objective in the master plan.
Okay, good. Is foliage going to be considered one of the appropriate fencing materials or?
When you say foliage, are you referring to landscaping, landscaping
along? I'm talking about instead of a fence, they put up a hedge.
If that's an option, you want
is that going to be considered?
It could be considered in the master plan, sure.
I think the operation and maintenance of that ought to be part of it. You're going to prohibit chain link fencing. And yet in your chart here, you include vinyl colored covered fencing, coated.
That's not intended to be
chain link fencing. I'm sorry. Vinyl coated chain link fencing is on one of your charts as an alternative in there. I don't know if that should be reconsidered or not, because that vinyl does not last forever. And before you know it, you've got a chain link fence that's just as bad as the original. So I'd give that some extra thought and reconsider it.
You can cross that out.
That's a great point.
Shall we just go around? So my thought is, Noel, I appreciate what you had to say, but I think we're looking at more than just below the hillsides here. We're also looking at Hawthorne Boulevard. Jerry actually was one of the first people to bring this issue up. There are some walls along there. There are chain link fence. There's no way chain link fence, in my opinion, looks good under any circumstances. And it just really does look like we might as well just put barbed wire on it. It's that bad. So to me, looking at these design issues, looking for some kind of a flow, I think it would be appropriate to move forward with that. I also think it's worth thinking about those areas that don't have anything. If the hill is very steep, why create a problem if there really is none in those locations? But if you could go back to those designs, I just wanted to throw my two cents in on them. Not any of these. The wrought iron is one of those lovely things that is very classy no matter how you look at it. And you can have wrought iron with fleur-de-lis on the top that actually would discourage people from jumping. But I don't see stucco as being productive. We call it yucco stucco if you go to Orange County. That's all you see is walls and walls of stucco blocking people off from one another. And a brick is not not indigenous to Palos Verdes, so I would rule brick out. But the PV stone and the wrought iron, and then you have to account for the view corridors. Like the arterials, by the way, this is not only Hawthorne Boulevard, as you pointed out, it's Silver Spur, it's also Palos Verdes Drive. And Palos Verdes Drive West has a lot of problems, guys. If you haven't looked at the Berry Hill side of Palos Verdes Drive West, that is a real issue that the city's had to contend with. So I think moving forward with something that that you can do, I think it's long overdue, and I support it.
Other questions, comments?
Just a comment, Mr. Mayor, to the speaker, with respect to privacy and security. I'm sensitive to that issue, but my observations over the years are that security can be easily circumvented by going down one property if you happen to be one of the lucky ones that your chain link is still up. I don't see any continuity there. Mm-hmm. And the upside walls and fences seem to be pretty consistent as you drive along Hawthorne. So, and I look at that on a regular basis. So I'm sensitive to it, but I don't, it hasn't changed my mind that I think that we need to remove the chain link fence and the collapsed pilasters, maybe all the pilasters, if we have the money to do that. And I'm with Noel on that. At this point in time, I think we should select a standard, but not necessarily mandate that there be a standard. Now, that's going to be a little haphazard there, but I like the no-wall option, especially on Hawthorne.
Where the pilasters are and the chain link fence.
That's right. And I like your idea. Wrought iron's very, very nice, but some people don't want people seeing into their backyard. Depending on where you are, we're talking all the arterials. I'm not sure that that's a good option.
I'm not talking about that either. I'm saying the ones where you can't see, like either goes way down the hill.
Right.
And you don't, it's just the edge.
Yeah.
But certainly not, yeah, people's backyards, they don't want that.
Some people don't mind, but some do, and I get that. So anyway, I think...
This is just a status report to receive and
file. I understand. We're giving some comments here, so those are my comments.
Well, no, they're asking for a modification here tonight, a pretty significant one. Yes, well, Ken?
I want to clarify that. We're asking you to authorize us to initiate code amendment proceedings, so we'd have to come back with the details.
Yeah.
So if I could add just a couple clarifications. I know when staff brought this forward a year ago, the focus that we had at that time was to go step by step, and this was just on Hawthorne. And we looked at just removing those rusty chain link fences, falling down, everything. Just removing them was beautification in and of itself.
Mm-hmm.
And doing that and getting permission from a very quick permission from a large amount of the homeowners so far, we found that in our code it says someone can replace a fence with the original material, meaning that someone could go down there and put up a new chain link fence. And so that's why, one of the reasons why we brought this forward now is to have the council allow us to start to look at bringing back an amendment for that to say, on the major arterials, we would alter that code to say you have to follow a fencing plan that's been approved by the council. I'd recommend, and I think Ara would recommend, that we look at that plan when we do bring it back, that it's probably unique to each major artery. In
Correct.
Other words, it's not a that's uniform thing that what's right for Hawthorne is right for Crenshaw, is right for Crest, and so on and so forth. And so right now, the focus for us is on Hawthorne and being able to start this work to remove all that fencing and start the work of coming back to you with what that code amendment might look
even,
like.
Even
as well.
On Hawthorne, you're not going to make it all uniform.
Correct.
Because there are places that have decent walls and fencing now. And what I was talking about is between arterials, like for a given track, between cross streets to make them look decent. And not have every house different. But you're not going to get Hawthorne to have one theme all the way down. That would be a replacement that would be excessive.
Sure, and especially on the area that we're talking about here where the chain link fencing would be removed, again, virtually all of it are steep hillsides on either side. And so the hope would be that there's no need for a new fence there by a homeowner, especially with many of those properties. If you don't have fencing going up the sides of your lot, the fence at the bottom doesn't really do a lot of good unless it's fenced all the way along. So that's been the thinking behind it as staff has brought it forward.
I think that when we do this, we ought to put some requirements on how they're constructed. Most of the pilasters fall over because they don't really have a foundation. They're just put on top of the ground, and the hillside pushes it over in no time at all. So not only the fence material and what it should look like, but
certainly
there should be some criteria for making them so they'll last.
Certainly.
And sometimes no pilasters. Right?
Well, I'm assuming all this is going to be done to current code, correct?
Correct.
Correct.
Mean, what other choice do you have? Ara, I've got a couple of questions here. What's the difference in a replacement cost of, and I'm thinking about some of the slopes on Hawthorne Boulevard, on the east side, where there's a small, I wouldn't call it a backyard, it's a slope. The slope is sloughing off, it's pushing down the chain link fences. If you take those chain link fences out, the slope could actually slough off more. I mean, some of those get pretty close to the foundations or are going to have an impact on the foundations. Point I'm getting to here is replacing the chain link fence with a retaining wall, because that's what some of them are going to require, is a gigantic price difference. And I'm concerned about that for a number of reasons. Number one, the potential from a legal standpoint of a taking of somebody's property. Number two, each one of these properties could be a little bit different from the others. Some may have to have a retaining wall because of the geologic issues. Who's going to pay for the, you know, for the soils reports or the geologic reports, let alone a retaining wall? I mean, the cost of a retaining wall is probably 10 times, maybe not 10 times, it's certainly 5 times per linear foot as a chain link fence. And we're gonna put this on our homeowners with 60 days notice to make a decision on this. I'm really concerned about, it's a laudable effort. And I said last year, the devil's gonna be in the details on it. But that's one cost, that's one concern I've got is to Councilman Dieta's point about coming up with one look for all of Hawthorne Boulevard, I don't think is possible.
No,
but between street to street, to your point, it might be street to street or intersection to intersection, but even within those intersections, depending on the geologic or just how long the current walls are going to last before they ever get replaced. Because we're not talking about forcing people to take it all down. We're talking about when they get replaced with the new look. Well, I could tell you, there's going to be walls out there 100 years from now. And I'm not saying that to be funny.
Yeah.
That's a fact. They're going to be out there 100 years from now. So it's a laudable effort. But we're never in our lifetimes or our kids' lifetimes ever going to have an Orange County-looking, consistent a feel to this whole thing, nor do I think that's what we're trying to achieve here. But that's
to clarify one point that I made earlier. My intent was that you shouldn't have a different kind of fence for each and every property.
Not for each house.
Not for each house.
For each local
area. You go along a street, and this one has brown, this one has stucco, this one has brick. Yeah. You want some reasonable continuity.
Some design continuity. I hear you on that. So I'm concerned about this being a never-ending project of us just chasing this rainbow of Hawthorne beautification, and we're never going to get there. So I talked about the debris falling down when the fence is removed. I didn't see a copy, maybe I missed it, of the release in here. Did we see a copy of that? Because I'm concerned about, for some of the homeowners that take the city up on removing those fences, what happens if there's some unintended, say, rains next winter or something like that, and that slope collapses or partially collapses and has an impact on their foundation?
Well, in the $500,000 that the council appropriated for this project includes not only the removal of the chain link fencing, but it also some of the slough material that's being supported by the chain link fence.
But those fences are holding up some of those hillsides, I fear.
I think as we've looked at it, because the chain link fence wouldn't be able to hold up the hillside. What you see there is vegetation that's sloughed over a 40 or 50 year period. That they're not, I mean, we've looked at them in detail. There's no chain link fencing there that's holding up. Well,
the slough itself is probably preventing additional slough from coming out. So if you remove the fence, remove the slough, I'm concerned that that's going to cause some unintended consequences there. Just making my overall point of chasing what I think or fear might be a never-ending project on it. I don't think 60 days is enough to react for folks. I think. They need more than that. I talked about a taking. I'd like to see a copy of that release. And as far as choosing tonight a look or colors or types of fences or just going in that direction. I would much prefer that we get the Planning Commission involved in,
well, that's
in
this.
That's what the that's recommendation
what
this,
is. No, that's get, what the recommendation
get them involved more before it comes back to us.
Well, I'm just giving initial feedback because we were asked to give initial feedback, correct?
Correct.
Well, and then what, it is going to the Planning Commission. That's part of the recommendation.
Susan, I hear you. I'm just giving
good
feedback, okay? So
well,
questions, comments,
part
it's
of the
all
recommendation.
I know, feedback.
Okay.
Some of it's for it, some of it's concerns. I'm done with my feedback. Any other input?
Yeah, I think Noel Park said it quite clearly when you look at Silver Spur. On the side, on one side of it, some of the neighbors there haven't planted anything to retain the slope. It's sloughed off, and the fence isn't holding it. The fence is collapsed. The pilasters are down. If you do a decent landscaping, you're not going to have this slope control. I've got a slope behind my yard that goes like 50 feet down, and it hasn't moved an inch because it's properly landscaped. So there are ways to fix it, but this is something we can charge the Planning Commission
right
to take a look at those options and come back to us with their recommendations, taking into account the comments we've made.
Okay, and in regards to modifying the
time interval?
No, the city code, section 17.76.030.
Well, because
That's on the table tonight also.
The recommendation is to initiate a code amendment to this particular code section. It'll go back to the Planning Commission for them to review and then come back to the City Council.
We're just asking for the review.
I'll move the staff recommendations for the fact that they'll receive the report, identify some things that we need to do with fences, and also look at submitting a change to our ordinance so that Council can act on it.
All three items, right?
All three.
Second.
So you're in favor of changing making the code amendment now?
No, it goes to the Planning Commission to come up with one and come back to us for review.
But how it's going to be presented to the Planning Commission is that the City Council voted in favor of this code amendment.
Yeah, initiating.
To initiate a code amendment.
No, it'll be reported to the commission that you've initiated the code amendment proceedings, and we'll propose the draft language, and then at that point, the commission will start to massage that language. So on page 4 of the staff report is the draft language that we've put together that addresses some of the unintended consequences. And so the commission will have a chance to wordsmith it and massage the language and forward a recommendation to the council.
We're not directing the wording. We're directing Planning Commission to look at it, wordsmith it, and bring it back to us.
And I appreciate the motion. I think this is. I need more information before I could support that. But that's okay. We'll see what the council wants to do. Any other questions? That was a motion, right?
Yes.
In a second. Any other questions, comments before we call the roll? Okay, Terry.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilman Mizutich?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
No.
Motion passes. Our next item, then, is item number 7, consideration and possible action to revise and approve the Community Development Department records retention schedule. I currently have 2 requests to speak.
Do we need a staff report on this? We've done this a number of times already, so
right,
we know
report
what this is about.
This is ministerial.
Can I make 2 comments?
Yeah, go ahead.
The key on the top of the proposed and the red line needs to get consistent. We got there the last time we did it, and it's different now. For example, superseded is on the new key. Anyway, if you can get that consistent, number one. And number two, if we can maybe even modify the staff report, because I think this is the third time we've seen it, and I think this council has
evolved?
It not only evolved, but did not agree with the staff report, and I guess that message wasn't heard. You know, we're talking about, we're discussing the rationale being, you know, data storage and all these different things. We don't need that because I think we didn't agree with it the first time through.
Fair enough. That's just my comment. Point well taken. Thanks.
Yeah.
All the California courts and the sky's falling.
I'll move staff recommendation.
No, we can't. We have to.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So call the speakers, please.
Mickey Rodich.
Good evening.
Good evening, council staff. I think it would be a serious mistake to authorize the destruction of city records only after a few years. They should be retained for a longer period of time. The destruction of these documents leads to loss of accountability and responsibility. No one will ever be held responsible for what they said or what they did in the past once these records are destroyed. In today's day and age, electronic storage is easy and reasonable. A perfect example of what I mean just came up tonight, Green Hills. The staff has been talking, and I've not been involved in the previous meetings where you went in some other departments, but we're putting storage for 5 years. We just heard that Green Hills has been going on for over 12 years. So after 5 years, you're going to destroy all these documents that are older than that. I think that's a big, serious mistake. And I think you should seriously think about what you're doing with storage. I think it's something that should be preserved. And it's easy enough and cheap enough to do. That's my comment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I do believe, though, that the records retention on Green Hills is indefinite.
Got another speaker.
Right? Records retention.
Next speaker, please.
Lowell Wiedemeyer.
Just make a comment.
Well, we couldn't hear you.
Good evening.
Good evening, all.
I'm speaking as an individual and not on behalf of any committee or other group. There's only one section of this that I'm focusing on, and that is the preservation within the development department of raw data, which supports expert reports. And historically, what has happened with this data is that it was reviewed by the, say, the geologists and the soil engineers on behalf of the city, and then given back to the applicants because it was too expensive to store it. And it wasn't really very useful. Even today, there are trailer fulls of boxes of documents that nobody can get to. That was simply not useful. Now, with electronic data processing and the fact that all of the raw scientific data is generally kept in electronic format in the first instance, it is easy to change the policy in the development department. Instead of throwing all that stuff back to the applicant, keep it. Because you create the potential that you can see data from multiple parcels in a larger context, but you can only do that if you keep it. Now, the proposal is to keep the summary reports. They're really not much use without the underlying data because you don't know what they mean. So my suggestion is that instead of giving back raw data or throwing it away, you simply record it and keep it along with the reports. I doubt that's going to make much difference in the process or the cost, but literally millions of dollars worth of geotechnology investigation has been done on the south side of the hill for the landslides. It's all been thrown away or given back, and it's not possible to go get it anymore. It's with an old firm that is no longer in business. So my suggestion is that it's feasible now for the first time to have the development department create a policy that they will require the filing of electronic raw data in addition to the report, and that the city store that, just as the reports are now stored indefinitely, so should the raw data be stored indefinitely. And that will allow you to create a body of knowledge. And remember, you have a GIS system now, and this can be tagged into the GIS system. It will become valuable, more valuable over the years as it rebuilds. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Lowell, before you, Mr. Mayor, Lowell, before you leave, you were talking about geological and soils reports. That's item number 9 on page 5 of the draft, and those are permanently kept, and those are the complete report submitted by project applicants for city's review, including correspondence with the geologist for its historic value.
Yes, so, but what's not there
is the raw
scientific measurements upon which the reports are based. That's given back, as my understanding.
No.
It's not now?
I'm reading, it says complete reports. I think it would include that data. That's the way I read it. But
For geology reports that are submitted for development applications, we keep all those reports, including the raw data. We have them. We have geology reports that go back even under the county.
Well, I understand, but I've looked at a lot of those, and in fact, they're summaries of the raw data rather than the raw data, a lot of them.
And that may be what came over when the city incorporated from the county. We obtained all that information, but we keep all those records. We have files and cabinets of all that raw data.
I think there's a difference between a geology report and a summary geology report. The geology report has to contain the data to support any of the conditions it's doing. And a summary is just that. You don't really worry about that. You worry about the basic report and the underlying data that supports the conclusions the report reaches.
Correct. And we keep all that information.
Yeah,
we never give back
that.
A geology report.
In fact, it
report.
Says so in a lot of places here where you only have a short term, it says accept geology reports. So.
Well, that's part of the report I do support, that it be kept indefinitely on this kind of science.
Yeah.
I would like to comment on Mr. Wiedemeyer's suggestion that we obtain raw data or the electronic data. I think that's a good suggestion, and that's something we could start practicing so that as we make that transition into more of the electronic files, we put that onus on the applicant. So that's something I'll try to implement within the next few weeks.
And most of the professionals generating that stuff, it's easy for them to send it over electronically.
Absolutely. That's the direction we're heading
towards. We should store all of it electronically.
A lot of this is permanent storage anyway, just as you've been talking about right now. What's the argument against permanently storing all of it, completion plus 10 instead of these twos, threes, fours? I mean, just keeping track of that, I think would be a little bit bothersome just from a labor standpoint.
And space. To keep all these records, we don't have the space. In fact, we're budgeting for some additional pods because we don't have the space to store all these records.
What about electronic versions of documents then?
Then that would be stored on the system's hard drives. So we start to transition into that phase, which is what we're working towards.
Do we not use a storage vendor? We keep all this stuff in pods?
Yeah, there's storage containers at City Hall.
Okay. I had no idea after all these years.
Community Development Department has 3 pods.
Wow. So if there was a fire,
it's all gone.
Water, all stuff? Roaches,
mildew.
You know, I would. Like,
they're all these documents throughout City Hall is exposed to all those elements.
Wow.
Why wouldn't we have a company?
Iron Mountain's a good company you guys might want to look into.
But they're expensive.
35
yeah, they
cents
are.
A box. I don't know how many boxes you got, but.
A lot. What, they'll store them or scan them?
Yeah, store them, scan them, the whole thing.
I think it's. Have you ever looked at implementing something like that, I mean, a long-term electronic professional storage system?
Yes, we have. We're looking into that. In fact, in our budget, we try to set some money aside to do that, to see what documents we can scan electronically and store them. But we haven't been able to, we've been able to scan some of the documents but not be able to dispose of them because of the retention policy.
Okay, but you could keep the electronic ones without the hard copies. if we
not based on the current.
No, I understand, but we could if we passed a policy on that. And the whole reason I bring this up is I think part of the reason we were able to come to a win-win solution with the Green Hills issue is because we did have access to long-term historical documents where we could take a look at some of the mistakes that were made, some of the lessons learned, which I think got the city on board with, you know what, let's step up and do the right thing because we had the history behind it. If we only had a couple of years worth of history, then we perhaps might have dug in deeper and which might have prolonged the litigation and led to a different result.
Can we move forward here?
So
can
just
we
a comment.
Move on here?
Question Our from the audience. Mickey, and I know you're a longtime businessman. What sort of solutions did you use?
Just a comment. There's a company called Box Incorporated that sells space in the cloud. But what they really sell is a software that allows you to take all of this data that you have, and I'm talking about large corporations, and make it accessible so that everybody can transfer to wherever their security levels are. So there's many other companies like that also, but I think you have a lot of things in electronic data right now that could be stored and should be saved instead of all of this hard copy.
Well, that's a good point. I mean, full disclosure, we use Box at our firm. We actually used two different systems. One's redundant to the other one, but it does. It allows us to have to collaborate internationally a lot easier than we might otherwise.
Right.
Okay. All right, so what's the council's thought on this? Sounds like we've got a potential future agenda item as far as records retainage. Do we want that to have an impact on our decision tonight, or we don't want to make a decision separate and apart from that potential agenda item?
I think my opinion is I'm in support of moving forward with this just to correct the record here or allow some flexibility, for example, disposing of hard copy once you have, you know, a QC'd electronic copy. We can't do that now, and we can do that moving forward.
I agree.
And we can address it going forward. I think all this, your suggestions and the crowd, I think is good. We need to look at that stuff, but we need to step forward at least.
I would agree if we had two electronic copies in separate locations, because you never know when a hard drive is going to go down.
Yeah.
Or cloud-based.
And it's cheap.
Yes.
So we'll move approval of this revised, let's see, the
record retention for
record retention.
Community development.
Yeah,
is that a motion?
It's a recommendation, revised and approved. Yeah.
Is that
a motion?
Yes.
I'll second.
Okay. Any other comments?
That's an unusually written recommendation, guys.
So I won't ask to attach this to the motion, but I think it is worthy of a future agenda item
to look at
discussing
process,
some of these other
process data. Rather than
correct.
Individual.
Yeah. Correct.
Maintaining the raw
data. Okay, so with no other comments, please call the roll.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Councilman Misetich?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem DeHovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes. Our next item then was formerly item number 9. It is consideration and possible action to appoint a city council member as an alternate director to the board of to the boards of sanitation districts number 5 and South Bay Sanitation District. And I have no request to speak, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, and I haven't spoken to anybody else about this, but just briefly before our meeting started tonight, city attorney.
Yes, on this item, in December, the mayor appointed the council, confirmed appointments on the sanitation district. In actuality, under the state law, the mayor is the representative. So in essence, the question tonight is how you want to deal with the alternate situation. Previously, Councilmember Brooks was appointed, and the alternate was Councilmember Misetich. And since the mayor is the delegate, really the question now is who the mayor would like to appoint as the alternate.
And I would just like to point out that the Sanitation District right now has Councilwoman Brooks as the alternate. So as far as their records are concerned, she is the alternate. This needed to be brought forward to clear the record. So if anybody's got any input on that or...
I'd like to make a motion that we affirm Mayor Campbell's appointment as the city's director of Sanitation District Number 5 and appoint Councilwoman Brooks as the city alternate director.
Second.
Any other comments, questions?
No, I love trash. I'm going to the solid waste event at Carson, if anybody wants to go next week. It'll be enticing.
Moving right along.
Aromatic. I don't know what word to say.
Please call the roll, please.
Just call the roll, please.
Councilman Mizutich?
Yes.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem DeHovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes. Our next item, then?
Next item is a Brown Act...
summary.
Presentation. This was...
presenting at this time of night to move it out. Yeah.
Right. Well, and also, this was my issue that I brought forward originally, and I know we've carried it over a couple of different meetings. I've had a chance to think about this. I also discussed it with one of my colleagues on the council of perhaps a more effective way of presenting this. So if it's okay with the rest of the council, I would just pull this for now, and I'll reconvene with the city attorney, and we'll kick this around so we can make better use of the council's time.
Sure.
When this lands on our desk.
I think it would be great as a booklet.
Are you pulling it permanently then?
No.
Because we've done this twice
may
before.
May I ask why?
Well, here's my thought. My thought is to look at the whole Brown Act and condense it down to just the issues that are germane to what we deal with, and then have it delivered to us electronically so that we could all take a look at it and get familiar with it. And then when it comes back at a future agenda item, we could move quickly through it with any sort of questions. And it may never get back to an agenda, but I just thought that would be more effective.
You know,
you attended the, I think, the League of Cities Brown Act seminar with me. You obviously weren't as good a student as I was, because I don't think I need this.
I don't need this either. We've been through two of them.
I love the Brown Act. It is like a Rubik's Cube of traps that you can inadvertently fall into.
The state legislators have exempted themselves from, which is wrong.
That is wrong. Not
only that, but the attorneys and courts have overinterpreted some parts of it.
So I guess to keep it simple, I would make a motion to simply pull this agenda item.
I'll pull the agenda.
Would the council like us to keep this on the tentative agendas or pull it off that until the council reports to us?
I would pull it off. We got budget season coming up.
We've done this.
So do I have a second on that?
Second.
All right. Call the roll, please.
Councilwoman Brooks?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Thank you. Councilman Mizutich?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem DeHovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes. Our next item then is item F, which was pulled earlier this evening. The consideration and possible action to oppose Senate Bill Number 649 regarding wireless telecommunications facilities. I do not have any request to speak.
Yeah, I pulled this item only because now I can't find the papers that we got. We got an email. I know Verizon, the letter is worded very strongly. It looks like something that we would all really support. The problem is that the letter we received details item for item, and it counters what is written in the letter. And now I don't know where it went. It was on my table here.
I have a copy for you.
But it goes through the bullet points, and it basically says that it asks us to defer taking action on this because I guess it's a work in progress. And of all places, Verizon, thank you, sent this to us. And they counterpoint a lot of the statements that are written by that come from the letter by the League of Cities. Now, I have a problem with the League of California Cities these days. The League of California Cities also supported that 12 cents gas tax.
Yes.
And all these other things. And there's just a lot of things coming out that while we are in the forefront of making changes on this item, this issue, they're trying to talk about identifying small projects and identifying small locations that are not consistent with what the way the letter is written to us from. So I just don't think we have all the information. And I'm just saying, if we defer action on this until we get further information, I just don't want to see us signing these things that, to me, look like we're not going to get the cell coverage we need in a small site that we might be able to do is something very innovative.
Are you proposing continuing this item, Councilwoman
Brooks?
Yeah,
I'm proposing to defer this item.
I will support that.
Okay.
Yes.
Defer, not necessarily continue.
When is the matter being heard by the legislators?
See, and I don't even have that information. But
I think it's urgent,
we need
Jerry.
To get, it's not urgent, and we need to get the information back, because how many times are we all doing this now? We go up the switchbacks, you go on PV Drive North, all of a sudden you're in and you're out of service where you never had a problem before. So if they're looking at doing something that is actually going to be on a small pole in a small location, that we can have feedback, because they are saying that we can have feedback, whereas that letter from I don't know what is going on with the League of California Cities lately, but I don't like the direction.
I'll go along, Mr. Mayor, with your motion there. I'm not sure I put as much weight into that. I read that letter, and I didn't, give as much weight to the arguments as you seem to have.
Yeah.
But I'm not happy about situations where, you don't, they tell you you have say-so, but, they're putting cell towers in front of people's houses now with boxes in front of it, and that's just
right, and so that's what this is not about. This is
about... these are the small ones, so yeah. Instead of putting one bigger one, you put 10 little ones.
But they're saying here that, local, I brought this up, let me just finish this, and then, they're saying here that local
ready.
Jurisdictions... And it wouldn't just go to the staff, it would go to the council. So that is the way I'm reading this. So that's what I'm concerned about, is that it's not something that's just staff-driven.
Yes, sir.
Sorry.
I tend to agree with Mayor Pro Tem Dehovic in that this can be a proliferation of little ones all over the place. And the objective here is we have no say in it, none whatever. Again, the whole purpose of the incorporation of the city was local control, and
right.
We keep giving it away. Why? I don't understand that.
Ken, we're not giving it
we're
away.
Not,
it's being taken from us.
Everything
that's
is.
A different,
I'm just
that's,
trying
that's
to figure
different.
Out what's
I understand
the
best. It's being taken, but by us not fighting for it, so it's not taken away, we're just capitulating.
No.
That's not necessarily what the bill says. That's all I'm
well,
saying.
I
just want us to make sure we know what we're signing.
I'd
say defer it.
I don't take the Verizon letter. I take it with a grain of salt. I mean, they've got an issue to push, and so.
Does staff have an opinion on that?
Yeah. Yes, I would agree with Councilmember Dida. This bill, again, the explanation I was given was that, hey, it's going to be amended, so don't come out against it because it's going to be amended that will be friendlier to you. But all we know is what's there right now. It is a bill that does start to strip our local authority to do exactly what the council wants. And again, Verizon has that right. They're at the state legislature to get something that's beneficial to them, not to us. I understand it. I get it. It's their right. I think all of us do. But the process that the council worked very hard on to put in place to regulate this, I think, is something that really works for Rancho Palos Verdes. And anything that strips the city of that authority, even a small amount, is an erosion of the ability that you have to really make a difference for your community. So I think it's, what they sent us is what they've been sending to many cities
yes.
in response
yes.
to to the league's draft. We will certainly do more research, regardless of whatever decision the council makes tonight. But we'd recommend that we go ahead and come out in opposition to it.
Our wireless ordinance doesn't limit us to just the big ones. Right. Our wireless antenna ordinance is for right. any antenna, even the little ones.
Yeah.
Why don't we retain that authority?
And if it comes out with amendments that turns out to be a really good bill, then you could support it.
Yeah.
Doug, may I? If we continue this to the next council meeting, do you see a problem with that at that point?
There's not a scheduled hearing between now and the next council meeting, but there could be.
I'd like to continue this to the next meeting. Get a little more information.
There was an April 4th hearing, so it's an active bill.
It's active.
So you mean that they could actually?
Yes, and the operative language is a small cell is a permitted use, not subject to city or county discretionary permit.
That's the way I read it.
I mean that's the land use authority. That's what it's dealing. So it's the continuation of the state taking parts of what we do and saying, okay, you lost authority over this, and
the next step will be the larger one. I mean, they're nickel and diming us to death by this. They did that a year ago in January. Okay.
You know,
they tried to backlog zoning into our general plan. They're doing it here. We've got to stop this as much as we can.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to approve staff recommendation.
Second.
With all due respect to Councilwoman Brooks, I've changed my mind. So okay. That's what I'd like to do.
Yeah. You got my second.
Okay. Call the roll, please.
Change my mind too, Gary.
Councilwoman Brooks?
No.
Councilman Dida?
Yes.
Councilman Mizutich?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Dohovic?
Yes.
Mayor Campbell?
Yes.
Motion passes. Our next item, then, for your consideration is the future agenda items.
Future agenda items?
Records retention. No. We were talking about raw material. Were we talking about that as a future agenda item?
Sure.
Giving Go staff ahead. The direction on the raw data on retention, as Lowell was explaining.
Or that's more broader, more direction on electronic data storage and so on and
right.
so forth.
That's okay. A staff issue.
To revisit part of our discussion earlier about our, not so much our commission, but our committees and taking a look at the process of formalizing the ability to bring items forward. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, from the
I just want to revisit interviews. It because I think, yeah.
Okay. Ken, anything?
No, I'll bring it at the next meeting. I'm preparing some white papers.
Anthony, anything? All right. I would, is it too early, Doug, is it too early to get a general overview of the City Hall site process? We've got a subcommittee on that.
It's not too early. Nothing's changed since the update that I gave the subcommittee, but certainly if the council wishes to have discussions, have an update on the agenda, we could do that.
I mean, I'm thinking something short, 10 minutes?
I think that's
a couple
important.
Of questions?
No, I think that we need to do that. The council needs to be up to speed on this.
Okay.
Okay.
And then
the other... Is that the consensus of the whole council? Okay.
No, that's fine.
Yeah,
and then the other item is sort of an add-on. Now that we've gotten 2.08 completed, is to bring forward the city policy and procedures, and have a review of those with an idea to modernize them if council desires.
It's funny you bring that up. I've looked at it. We've got, 58 policies, and some of them are outdated and need updating. So you're talking about reviewing all those policies, no. And they're a page each, half a page each. They're not that no. long. They need to be updated. Actually,
no,
we did
no, it's
not.
2.08. It's no. separate we separate also, topic. This is policies
doing that,
and procedures.
We also need to look at our last summer's meeting where we had a council meeting at Taranea, and we identified a number of policies that
yeah.
should be included.
Right.
And when we did 2.08, there were two items I put in that our city attorney recommended we include
Correct.
Those as policies.
Right.
So
That might be an additional policy.
Need to put all that in a package and get it to council.
Sounds good.
Okay.
Like, we don't have enough work already.
All right, anything else? No, next item.
City Council oral reports. Do we need to extend the meeting?
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to extend the meeting another 5 minutes to 11:13.
I'll second that.
11:13?
So
I want 5 minutes. That's it.
Who wants to go first on oral reports?
I'll go first.
Okay.
On 4-6, met with the Director of Finance for a pre-budget brief. That was very helpful, Deborah. Thank you. And the City Manager also. On 4-6, met with Councilman Dida and Gabby Yap on the East Side ALPR issue. That was very helpful. That'll be, hopefully we'll get some significant movement there. 4-10, the budget workshop with my colleagues here. 4-17, had a very happy phone call from the resident next to Sunnyside Ridge. I guess we are going to finalize that and bring that forward under completed status. There was a bit of an issue going back and forth, and I'd like to thank the city attorney for moving that forward. And I think that's it. Oh, the other couple things is a lot of issues these days, a lot of phone calls with residents on the east side with respect to issues with Southern California Edison. Thank you to staff, Nicole and Ara and city manager and everybody for jumping on that. You know, these people are working well into the night, and you know, wires laying on roofs and views being impeded, et cetera, et cetera. So we're attacking that as best we can. And I think at least the two residents I know thus far are pretty happy about staff's proactivity. So thank you.
On Monday the 10th, I was here with the rest of my colleagues participating in the budget workshop. On 4-13th, I attended the South Bay COG legislative breakfast. Attending there was State Senator Bradford and Assemblyman Mike Gibson to give us a report on what's happening in Sacramento. They seemed apologetic on raising our gas taxes, but I don't think they really were. Anyway, they claim it's for infrastructure, and my concern is, well, over the past several years, you've had money for infrastructure. Why haven't you been paying and investing in infrastructure at that time? And then on Saturday the 15th, I attended the Egg Hunt Extravaganza, which is an event that I love to attend because I like to get my picture with the Easter Bunny. And Mayor Campbell and I got our picture with the Easter Bunny. I love to watch the kids go out and find Easter eggs. I think that's just a hoot. Yeah. And it's a great event. I'm glad I attended.
One of my favorite events. Sorry I missed it, but I had to stay out of the sun. So.
I actually didn't get to go this year because I had my photo taken with a goat. Something finally got my goat. I've got a goat. Actually, it was the Land Conservancy. They had there for their donors, they had your photo with a goat, and they had baby goats in Ormaga Canyon. They were so precious. They were more soft and mellow than anything I've ever held, than any, even a little rabbit or a dog. I mean, just so precious.
They're all gone now. The coyotes got them.
Actually, they're at City Hall. I just saw them on the side of the property, on fenced off. But that was a beautiful day. The Land Conservancy was very well organized, and those goats were out there. On the 4th of April, I went to Supervisor Hahn's open house in her new San Pedro office. And
forgot I was
and
there,
so
too.
So was Jerry Dehovic was there. He breezed in and out on his way to another meeting. And then on the 10th, attended the budget, workshop with the others. On the 14th, I attended the mayor's breakfast with Brian and members of the committee chairs and our city manager and everybody was able to give really good feedback about activities of importance to the city. So it's always been a good venue. On the and then I've just been receiving, Captain Berenger, I think you know, a lot of phone calls have started again about the motorcycles on the switchbacks. Those guys are back. I guess the cyclists went away for a little while, and now the motorcycles are back. So, just, and then, of course, there are a lot of angry people about all the work we're doing on our roads, which I've talked about earlier. So anything that we can do to time them around the school hours would be great. And that's my report. Thank you.
Ken.
Okay. Yeah, I was also at the budget session on the 10th, but had a very good meeting on the 12th with our finance director and Ray Mathies. We have come up with something that can be looked at as an approach for others to then qualify with a feasibility study, taking advantage of one that was prepared some time ago, to move forward and finally stop treating the symptoms but dealing with the cause of the Portuguese Bend land flow. It can be controlled, and that's one of the things we're going to do.
I'm eager to help you.
Okay, I don't recall if I said this at the last council meeting, but I attended the Land Conservancy annual advisory council meeting. I think, a welcome change from years past, and that I think they're embracing a lot more collaboration with their partners, and in this case, the land owners, which is the city. Also went to, over Easter weekend, went to the egg hunt. I brought my newly minted 15-year-old son along because he used to participate in that egg hunt a lot. But he figured since he's 6 feet tall now, it would be an unfair advantage to actually go out there and participate, although I know he was thinking about it. Went to the last month's sanitation district board meeting, mayor's lunch, mayor's breakfast, which was already talked about. I did attend the Palos Verdes Estates Council swearing in and said a few words on behalf of all of us up here to those departing council people and their treasurer, and congratulated their two new council people that have just been sworn in. And then a question for the city manager. I get a lot of requests of where the goats are because people want to go see the goats. Do we have some place where we can track that, something we can throw up in the city website for the next couple of months while they're does it exist already?
It doesn't exist already, but I think we can get our hands on it and get it up on the website in an easily locatable place.
I'd love to be able to tell people where to go on the website instead of.
Yeah, but like today, they were right on Hawthorne Boulevard. Yeah. It would have been dangerous for people to stop there. So,
And that's it. So next item.
Is adjournment, Mr. Mayor?
Motion to adjourn.
And is that me? And if I may simply add that we are adjourning to 5:30 p.m. on May 2nd for an adjourned regular meeting.
Oh, gosh. That's it.
I missed that.
Another 5:30 meeting?
For the May 2nd.
Got it, okay.
Upcoming one.
Yeah, these becoming standing 5:30 meetings now, or what?
Well, when you look at things that been told to put on the closed session,
we got done at a reasonable hour, given how much we accomplished tonight. And so if anybody's got a problem with an early start, I know that sometimes that's an issue.
I have a problem with a late end. I don't have a problem with an early start. How about you?
So with that, thank you, everybody.
I'm up at 6 and I don't go to bed before midnight.